The Farmer's Boy by Clifton Johnson.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Elsie. The Farmer's Boy by Clifton Johnson. Prefatory Note. In what this volume tells of the Farmer's Boy, readers will find that many episodes and interests in the life of the boy are not even mentioned. One book, indeed, would not contain them all. There is, however, one important omission that is intentional: his school life. The reason for this is that the writer treated the subject in detail in a volume uniform with this, published last year. Its title is The Country School in New England, and its publishers are D. Appleton & Company of New York. It is also to be explained that, while the present volume is primarily about the boy on the farm, it is intended that the rest of the family, in particular the girl, shall not altogether lack attention, either in text or pictures. Clifton Johnson, Hadley, Mass., June 1894.
Part 1. Winter. On New Year's morning, the first thing the boy hears is the voice of his father calling from the foot of the stairs.
Come, Frank. Time to get up.
You may perhaps imagine that the boy leaps lightly from his bed and that he is soon clattering merrily down the stairs to the tune of his own whistle. But the real live boy, who will fit so romantic and pretty an impression, it would be hard to find. Our boy Frank is so unheroic as to barely grunt out a response that shall give his father to understand that he has heard him. And then he turns over and slumbers again. It is 6 o'clock. The first gray hints of the coming day have begun to penetrate the little chamber. The boy's clothing lies in a heap on the floor, just where he jumped out of it in his haste the night before, to get out of the frosty atmosphere and into his bed. In one corner of the room is a decrepit chair, whose cane seat bottom had some time ago increased its original leakiness to such a degree that it had been judged unsuited to the pretensions of the living room below stairs, and been banished to the chambers. An old trunk with a cloth cover thrown over it, and a stand with a cracked little mirror above, are the other most striking articles of furnishing. The walls of the room are not papered, and where the bed stands, the bedposts have bruised the plaster, so that you catch a glimpse or two of the lath behind. Yet the walls are not so bare as they might be, for the vacant space is made interesting by a large, legal-looking certificate that affirms that the boy's father, by the payment of $30, has been made a life member of the Home Missionary Society. The boy is rather proud of this fact, for though he does not know what it all means, he feels sure it is something good and religious. He often reads the certificate and ciphers out the names of the distinguished men who have put their signatures at the foot of the document, and he likes to look at the Bible scene pictured at the top, and takes pleasure in the elaborate frame, all made out of hemlock and pine cones. He is tempted to the belief that he is blessed above most boys in having a father who has the honor to be a life member of the Home Missionary Society, and who possesses such a certificate in such a frame. Indeed, he has gone much further than this upon occasion, and has complacently concluded that his folks were pretty sure of going to heaven in the end. At any rate, their chances were better than those of most of the neighbors. He knew very well his folks were more religious than most. And wasn't his father a life member of the Home Missionary Society? Our boy did not think these thoughts on New Year's morning. Getting up time came while it was still too dark to make out much besides the dim shapes of the articles about the room. Even the gaily colored soap advertisement he had hung next to the missionary certificate was dull and shapeless, and the garments depending from the long row of nails in the wall at the foot of the bed could not be told apart. The morning is very cold. The window panes are rimed with frost so that hardly a spot of clear glass remains untouched, and there is a cloudy puff of vapor from among the pillows with the boy's every outgoing breath. The boy's father, after he had properly warned his son of the approach of day, made the kitchen fire and went out to the barn to feed the cattle. When he returns to the house, he appears to be astonished that Frank has not come down, though one would think he might have got used to it by this time. He stalks to the upstairs door and says, in tones whose sternness seems to prophesy dire things if not met with prompt obedience,
Frank, do you hear me? I called you a quarter an hour ago. I want you to get up right off.
Coming, says Frank, and he rubs his eyes and tries to muster resolution to get out into the cold.
Well, it's about time, returns his father, and you better be spry about it, too.
When you sleep on a feather bed, it lets you down into its yielding mass, so that if you have enough clothes on top, you can sleep in tropical contentment. There is no chance for the frost to get in at any of the corners. Frank felt that his happiness would be complete were he allowed to doze on half the morning in his snug nest, but he knew it was hopeless aspiring to such bliss. And a few minutes later he appeared downstairs, and the way he appeared was this. His hair was tumbled topsy-turvy, his eyes had still a sleepy droop, and he was in his shirt sleeves and stocking feet. He had no fondness for freezing in his room any longer than was necessary after he was once out of bed, and he always left such garments as he could spare downstairs by the stove. Of course he had not washed. That he would do just before breakfast at the kitchen sink after the outdoor work was done. The half-dressed boy, as soon as he gets downstairs, hastens to make friends with the sitting-room stove, where a fire, with the aid of chunks, has been kept all night. A light is burning in the kitchen, and his mother is clattering about there, thawing things out and getting breakfast. The boy hugs the stove as close as nature of it will allow, and turns himself this way and that to let the heat soak in thoroughly all around. Then he puts on the heavy pair of shoes he left the night before in a comfortable place back of the stove, gets his collar on and his vest and coat, pulls a cap down over his ears, and shuffles off to the barn. Frank is 13 years old, but he has been one of the workers whom it has seemed necessary to stir out the first thing in the morning for years back. He knew how to milk when he was 7, and he began to bring in wood a stick at a time, about as soon as he could walk. He did not grumble at his lot, nor think it a hard one, nor would he had it been 10 times worse. Indeed, children, unless set a bad example by the complaining habits of their elders, or because they are spoiled by petting and lack of employment, accept things as they find them and make the best of them. Even the farm debt, which may burden the elders very heavily and keep all the family on the borders of shabbiness for years, makes but a light and occasional impression on the youngsters. Then as to those accidents that are continually happening on the farm, and that are so heartbreaking and discouraging to the poorer ones, the collapse of a wagon, the sickness of the best cow, the death of the old horse, the giving out of the kitchen stove so that a new one is absolutely necessary. The children may shed a few tears, but work in the little pleasures they so readily discover under the most untoward conditions soon make the sun shine again, and the mists of trouble melt into forgetfulness. Boys on small farms which have only 2 or 3 cows do not milk regularly. The farmer or an older brother does it. But if the rest of them are away from home or too busy with other work, the boy is called upon. Perhaps the father has to go so many miles over the hills to market that he will not get home until well on in the evening. In that case, you find the boy at nightfall poking about the glooms of the barn with a lantern and doing all the odd jobs that need to be done before he can milk. When these are finished, the little fellow gets the big tin pail at the house, hangs his lantern on a nail in the stable and sits down beside one of the cows. He sets the milk streams playing a pleasant tune on the resonant bottom of the pail, and from time to time snuggles his head up against the cow for the sake of the warmth. If the cow gives a pailful, his knees begin to ache and shake with the weight of the milk before he has done, and his fingers grow cramped and stiff with their long continued action. However, the boy always perseveres to the end, and if when he takes the milk in, his mother says he has got more than his pa does, he grows an inch taller in conscious pride of his merits. There is a difference in cows. Some require a good deal more muscle than others to bring the milk. Some are skittish. One of these uneasy cows will keep whacking you on the ear with her tail every minute or two all through the milking. And at the same time, the coarse and not over-clean tuft of hair on the end will go stinging along your cheek. Then the cow will be continually stepping away from you sideways, and you have to keep edging after her with your stool. These unexpected and uncalled-for dodges make the streams of milk go astray, and you get your overalls and boots well splashed as one of the results. Another is that you lose your temper and give the cow a fierce rap with your fist. That makes matters worse instead of better. The cow seems to have no notion of what you are chastising her for and gets livelier than ever. It sometimes happens in the end that the cow gives the boy a sudden poke with a hind foot that sends him sprawling, pail, stool, and all. Then the boy feels that his cup of sorrow has run over. He knows that his pail of milk has. When a boy gets into trouble, he always feels that the best thing he can do is to go and hunt up his mother. That is what our boy, who met disaster in the cow stable, did. He left his lantern behind, but he carried in the pail with a dribble of milk and foam that was still left in the bottom. His mother was cutting a loaf of bread on the supper table. "Are you through so soon?" she asked. "Why, Johnny, what is the matter?" she says, noticing his woebegone face. "The cow kicked me," replies Johnny. His mother gets excited and steps over to examine him. "Well, I should say so," she exclaimed. "You're completely plastered from head to foot. Spilt all the milk, too, didn't it? Well, well, what's the matter with the old cow?"
"I don't know," replied Johnny tearfully. "She just up and kicked me right over."
"Well, now, Johnny, never mind," said his mother soothingly. "You needn't try to milk her any more tonight. You better tie her legs together next time when you milk. She's real hateful, that cow is. I've seen the way she'll hook around the other cows lots of times. Here, you run into the bedroom, and I'll get your Sunday clothes for you to change into. Wait a minute till I lay down a newspaper for you to put your old duds onto." A little later, Johnny went out to the barn and brought in the lantern. Then he sat down to supper, and by the time he had eaten 10 mouthfuls of bread and milk, he felt entirely comforted and blissful after his late trials. The boy's usual work at night was to let the cows in from the barnyard where they had been standing, to get down hay and cut up stalks for them, water and feed the horses, bring in wood, not forgetting kindlings for the kitchen stove and chunks to keep the sitting room fire overnight. And last but not least, he had to do all the odd helping his father happened to call on him for. The boy enjoyed most of this, more or less, but his real happiness came when work was done and he could wash up and sit down to his supper. The consciousness that he had got through the day's labor, the comfort of the indoor warmth, the keen appetite he had won, all combined to give such a complacency, both physical and mental, as might move many a grown-up and pampered son of fortune to envy. The boy usually spends his evenings very quietly. He studies his lessons on the kitchen table, or he draws up close to the sitting-room fire and reads a story paper. There is not so much literature in the average family, but that the boy will go through this paper from beginning to end, advertisements and all, and the pictures half a dozen times over. In the end, the paper is laid away in a closet upstairs, and when he happens on dull times and doesn't know what else to do with himself, he wanders up there and delves in this pile of papers.
He finds it very pleasant, too, stirring up the echoes of past enjoyment by a renewed acquaintance with the stories and pictures he had found interesting long before. Evenings are varied with family talks, and sometimes the boy induces his grandfather to repeat some old rhymes, tell a story, or sing a song. When there are several children in the family, things often become quite lively of an evening. The older children are called upon to amuse the younger ones, and they have some high times. There are lots of fun and noise, and squalling too, and some energetic remarks and actions on the part of the elders, calculated to put a sudden stop to certain of the most enterprising and reckless of the proceedings. The baby is a continual subject of solicitude. His tottering steps give him many a fall anyway, and he aspires to climb everything climbable. And if he doesn't tumble down two or three times getting up, he is pretty sure to do it after the accomplishment of his ambition. Then he makes astonishing expeditions on his hands and knees. You feel yourself liable to stumble over and annihilate him almost anywhere. The parents realize these things, and is it any wonder when the rest of the flock gets to flying around the room full tilt that they become alarmed for the baby, and that their voices get raspy and forceful? Blind man's buff and tag and general skirmishing are not altogether suitable to the little room where, besides the chairs and the lounge and organ, there's a hot stove and table with a lamp on it. You need some practice to get much satisfaction from a conversation carried on amid the hubbub. You have to shout every word, and if the children happen to have a special fondness for you, they do most of their tumbling right around your chair. Some of the children's best times come when the father and mother throw off all other cares and thoughts, and become for the time being their companions in the evening enjoyment. What roaring fun they have when Papa plays wheelbarrow with them, and puzzles them with some of the sleight-of-hand tricks he learned when he was young, or when Mama becomes a much-entertained listener while the oldest boy speaks a piece and rolls his voice and keeps his arm waving in gestures from beginning to end. The other children are quite overpowered by the larger boy's eloquence. Even the baby sits in quiet on the floor and lets his mouth drop open in astonishment. The mother is apt to be more in sympathy with these goings-on than the father, and I fancy it is on such occasions as he happens to be absent that they have most of this sort of celebration. At such a time, too, the children wax confidential and tell what they intend to be when they grow up. This one will be a storekeeper. This one will be a minister. This one a doctor. This one a singer. They all intend to be rich and famous and to do some fine things for their mother some day. They do not pick out any of the callings for love of gain primarily, but because they think they will enjoy the life. Indeed, when Tommy said he was going to be a minister, the reason he gave for this desire was that he wanted to ring the bell every Sunday. Bedtime comes on a progressive scale, gauged by the age of the individual. First the baby is metamorphosed and tucked away in his crib. Then the three-year-old goes through a lingering process of preparation, and after a little run in his nightgown around the room, he is stowed away in crib number two, and his mother sings him a lullaby or a song from gospel hymns, and that fixes him for the night. These two occupy the same sleeping room as the parents, and it adjoins the sitting room. The door has been open all evening and is comfortably warm. Girls and boys of 8 or 10 years old would take their lamps and march off to the cold upper chambers at 8 o'clock or before. Some of the upper rooms may have a stovepipe running through which serves to blunt the edge of the cold a trifle, or there may be a register or hole in the floor to allow the heat to come up from below. But as a rule, the chambers are shivery places in winter, and when the youngsters jump in between the icy sheets, their teeth are set chattering, and it is some minutes before the delightful warmth which follows gains its gradual ascendancy. The boy who sits up as late as his elders is usually well started in his teens. The children are not inclined to complain of early hours unless something uncommon is going on. They are tired enough by bedtime.
Even the older members of the family are physically weary with the day's work, and the evening talk is apt to be lagging and sleepy in its tone, and the father gets to yawning over his reading, and the mother to nodding over her sewing. Many times the chiefs of the household will start bedward soon after 8, and as to the growing boy, he usually disregards the privilege of late hours, and takes himself off at whatever time after supper his tiredness begins to get overpowering. It would be difficult to say surely that the boy's room I described early in this chapter was an average one. The boy is not coddled with the best room in the house. In some dwellings the upper story has but 2 or 3 rooms that are entirely finished. The rest is open space roughly floored, and with no ceiling but the rafters and boards of the roof. There are boys who have a bed or two in such quarters as these, or in a little half-garret room in the L. These unfinished quarters are the less agreeable if the roof happens to be leaky. Sounds of dripping water or sifting snow within one's room are not pleasant. On the other hand, there are plenty of boys who have rooms with striped paper on the walls and possibly a red carpet underfoot, not to speak of other things no less ornate. In the matter of knick-knacks, most boys do not fill their rooms to any extent with them. The girls are more apt to do this. But a boy is pretty sure to have some treasures in his room. He is not very particular where he stows them, and he is likely to have some severe trials about house-cleaning time. His mother fails to appreciate the value of his special belongings, and is not in sympathy with his method of placing them. They get disarranged and thrown away. If fortune favors the boy with the drawers of an old bureau, he is fairly safe. But things he puts on the shelf and stand, and especially those he puts right along there in a row under the head of the bed, oh, where are they? A winter breakfast on a farm is over about sunrise. All the rolling hills near and far lie pure and white beneath the dome of blue, and they sparkle with many a frosty diamond, and sunward gleam and dazzling radiance. I doubt if the boy cares very much about this. He is no stickler for beauty, and movements affect him usually but mildly as a matter of beauty or sentiment, though in a simple way many things touch him to a degree. But commonly the phase that presents itself uppermost is a physical one. The sun shines on the snow, it blinds his eyes. A gray day is the dismal forerunner of a storm. Sunsets, unless particularly gaudy, have no interest, except as they suggest some weather sign. He delights more in days that are crystal clear, when every object in the distant hills and valleys stands sharply distinct, than in the mellow days that soften the landscape with their gauzy blues. He loves action, not dreams. Boys, like animals, feel a friskiness in their bones on the approach of a storm. They will run and shout then for the mere pleasure of it, and play of whatever sort gets an added zest. It may be the dead of winter, but that does not keep them indoors. If the wind blows a gale and whistles and rattles about the home buildings and makes the trees crack and creak, so much the better. Nor will the onset of the storm itself drive them indoors. The whirling flakes may increase in number till they blur all the landscape and go seething and shifting windrows over every hillock. Yet it will be some time before the children will pause in their sliding, skating, or running to think of the indoor fire. When they do go in, it is as if all the outdoor breezes had gained sudden entrance. They all come tumbling through the door with a bang and a rush, and there is a scattering of clinging snow when they pull off their wraps and throw them into convenient chairs or corners. They declare they are almost frozen as they stamp their feet about the kitchen fire and hug their elbows to their bodies and rub their fingers over the stove's iron top. "Well, why didn't you come in before then?" asks their mother. "Oh, we was playing," is the answer. "We've been having a lots of fun. The snow's drifted up the road, so it's over our shoes now." "You better take off your shoes, if you've got any snow in them," the mother says. "I declare how you have slopped up the floor. And you've made it cold as a barn here, coming in all in a lump that way. Here, Johnny, don't you go into the sitting room till you get kind of dried off and decent."
I just wanted to get the cat, says Johnny. Well, you can't go in on the carpet with such looking shoes, cat or no cat, is his mother's response. Meanwhile, she has taken her broom and brushed out on the piazza some of the snow lumps and puddles of water the children have scattered. The indoor stoves are an important item in the boy's winter life. It is a matter of perpetual astonishment to him how much wood those stoves will burn. He has to bring it all in, and he finds it as much of a drudgery as his sister does the everlasting washing and wiping of the dishes. It is his duty to fill the wood boxes about nightfall each day. The woodshed is half dark, and the day has lost every particle of glow and warmth. He can rarely get up his resolution to the point of filling the wood boxes chuck full. He puts in what he thinks will do, and lives in hope he will not be disturbed at other plans by having to replenish the stock before the regulation time the night following. Sometimes he tries to avoid the responsibility of a doubtfully filled woodbox by referring the case to his mother. "Is that enough, Mama?" he asks. "Well, have you filled it?" she asks. "It's pretty full," replies the boy. "Well, perhaps that'll do," responds his mother sympathetically, and the boy becomes at once conscience-free and cheerful. All through the day when the boy is in the home neighborhood, he is continually resorting to the stoves to get warmed up. Every time he comes in, he makes a few passes over the stove with his hands, and he must be crowded for time if he cannot take a turn or two before the fire to give the heat a chance at all sides. If he has still more leisure, he gets an apple from the cellar or a cookie from the pantry and eats it while he warms up. Or he goes in and sits by the sitting room stove and reads a little in the paper. One curious thing he early finds out is that he gets cold much quicker while he is working than when he is playing. Probably the majority of New England boys spend most of the winter in school. Though in the hill towns where roads are bad and houses much scattered, the smaller schools are closed. While he attends school, the boy has not much time for anything but the home chores. But on Saturdays and in vacation, he may at times go into the woods with a man. There is no small excitement in clinging to the sled as it pitches along the rough wood roads amid a clanking of chains and the shouts of the driver. The man who is familiar with the work seems to have no hesitation in driving anywhere and over all sorts of obstacles. The boy does not know whether he is most exhilarated or frightened, but he has no thought of showing a lack of courage, and he hangs on, and when he gets to the end of the journey, thinks he has been having some great fun. The boy has his own small axe and is all eagerness to prove his virtues as a woodsman. He whacks away energetically at some of the young growths, and when he brings a sapling 4 inches through to the ground, he is triumphant, and wants all the others to look and see what he has done. He finds himself getting into quite a sweat over his work, and he has to roll it up his earlaps and get his overcoat off and hang it on a stump. Then he digs into the work again. In time, the labor becomes monotonous to him, and he is moved to tramp through the snows and investigate the work of the others. There is his father making a clean, wide gash in the side of a great hemlock. Every blow tells, and seems to go just where he wanted it to. The boy wonders why, when he cuts off a tree, he makes his cut so jagged. He stands a long time watching his father's chips fly, and then gains a safe distance to see the tree tremble and totter as the opposite cuts deepen at the base near its heart. What a mighty crash it makes when it falls! How the snow flies and the branches snap! The boy is awed for the moment, then is fired with enthusiasm and rushes in with his small axe to help trim off the branches. After a time there comes a willingness that his father should finish the operation, and he wanders off to see how the others are getting on. By and by he stirs up the neighborhood with shouts to the effect that he has found some tracks. His mind immediately becomes chaotic with ideas of hunting and trapping. Now that he has begun to notice, he finds frequent other traps, and some, he is pretty sure, are those of foxes, and some of rabbits and some of squirrels. Why, the woods are just full of game. He will bring out his box trap tomorrow, and the certainty grows on him that he will not only get some creatures that will prove a pleasant addition to the family larder, but will have some furs nailed up on the side of the barn that will bring him a nice little sum of pocket money. That evening he brought out the box trap and got it into practice, and made all the younger children wild with excitement over the tracks he had seen in his plans for trapping. They all wanted a share and were greatly disappointed the next day when their father would not let them go too. The boy set his trap and moved it every few days to what he thought would prove a more favorable place, but he had no luck to boast of. Yet he caught something 3 times. The first time he had the trap set in an evergreen thicket in a little space almost bare of snow. He was pleased enough one day to find the trap sprung, and at once became all eagerness to know what he had inside. He pulled out the spindle at the back and looked in, but the tiny hole did not let in light enough. Very cautiously he lifted the lid a trifle. Still nothing was to be seen, and he feared the trap had sprung itself. When he ventured to raise the lid a bit more, a little slim-legged field mouse leaped out. The boy clapped the lid down hard, but the mouse hopped away, and in a flash had disappeared in a hole at the foot of a small tree. The boy was disappointed in having even such a creature escape him. The next time, whatever it was he caught, gnawed a hole through the corner of the box, and had gone about its business when our boy made his morning visit to the trap. Then he took the trap home and lined the inside with tin. He had no luck for some days after, and finally forgot the trap altogether. It was not till spring that he happened upon it again. He felt a tingle of the old excitement in his veins when he saw that the lid was down. He opened it with all the caution born of experience, but the red squirrel which was within had been long dead. And when the boy thought of its slow death by starvation in that dark box, he felt that he would never want to trap any more in that way. The boy finds the woods much more enjoyable than the woodpile when it is deposited in the home yard. He knows that as long as there is a stick of it left, he will never have a moment of leisure that will not be liable to be interrupted with a suggestion that he go out and shake the saw a while. The hardest woods that make the hottest fires are the ones that the saw bites into the most slowly and are most discouraging. The best the boy can do is to hunt out such soft wood as the pile contains and all the small sticks. He makes some variety in his labor by pulling up the sawed sticks in a bulwark to keep the wind off, only it has to be acknowledged that he never really succeeds in accomplishing this purpose. But the unsawed pile grows gradually smaller, and his folks are not so severe that they expect the boy to do a man's work, or to keep at it as steadily. He stops now and then to play with the smaller children, and to go to the house to see what time it is, or to get something to eat. Besides, his father works with him a good deal, and if there are times when the minutes go slowly, the days as a whole slip along quickly, and before the boy is aware, winter is at an end if the woodpile isn't. End of Part 1, Winter.
Part 2 of The Farmer's Boy by Clifton Johnson. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Read for you by Chiquito Craster. Spring. With the coming of March comes spring, according to the almanac. But in New England, the snowstorms and wintry gales hold sway often to the edge of April. Yet you can generally look for some vigorous thaws before the end of the month. There are occasional days of such warmth and quiet that you can fairly hear the snow melt, and the air is full of the tinkle of running brooks. You catch the sound of a woodpecker tapping in the orchard, and the small boy tumbles into the house, jubilant over the fact that he has seen a bluebird flitting through the branches of the elm before the house. All the children make haste to run out into the yard to see the sight. Even the mother throws a shawl over her head and steps out on the piazza. "Yes, sir, there he is," says Tommy excitedly. "That's a blue bird, sure, Pop." Puddles have gathered in the soggy snow along the roadside, and the little stream in the meadow has overflowed its banks. When the boy perceives this, he becomes immediately anxious to get into his rubber boots and go wading. His mother has a doubtful opinion of these waitings, but it is such a matter of life and death to the boy that she has not the heart to refuse him, and contents herself with admonitions not to stay out too long, not to wade in too deep, not to get his clothes wet, etc., etc. The boy begins with one of the small puddles, for he has these cautions in his mind. But the scope of his enterprise continually enlarges, and he presently finds himself trying to determine just how deep a place he can get into without letting the water in over his boot tops. He does not desist from the experiment until he feels a cold trickle down one of his legs, from which he concludes that he got in just a little too far that time, and he makes a hasty retreat. But he has made his mind easy on the point as to how deep he can go, and now turns his attention to poking about with a stick he has picked up. He is quite charmed with the way he can make the water and slush spatter with it. When he gets tired with this, and the accumulating wet begins to penetrate his clothing here and there, he adjourns to the meadow and sets his stick sailing down the stream there. It fills his heart with delight to see the way it pitches and whirls, and he slumps along the brook borders and shouts at it as he keeps it company. Later he returns to the roadway and makes half a dozen dams or more to stop the tiny rills that are coursing down its furrows. He does this with such serious thoughtfulness and with such frequent, studious pauses as would well fit the actions of some of the world's great philosophers. No doubt the boy is making discoveries and learning lessons, for the farm, with varied nature always so close, is an excellent kindergarten, and the farm child is all the time improving its opportunities after some fashion. When our boy goes indoors, his mother shows symptoms of alarm over his condition. He thinks he has kept pretty dry, but his mother wants to know what on earth he's been doing to get so wet.
"Ain't been doing nothing," says Tommy. "Well, I should say so," remarks his mother. "Here, you let me sit you in this chair to kind of dream off while I pull off them sopping mittens."
She has to wring the mittens out at the sink before she hangs them on the line back of the stove. Next, she pulls off the boy's boots and stands him up while she takes off his overcoat, and lastly pushes him, chair and all, up by the fire, where he can put his feet on the stove hearth. Tommy did not see the necessity for all this fuss. He felt dry enough and all right. Yet, as long as his mother does not get disturbed to the chastising point, he finds a good deal of comfort in having her attend to him in this way. It was on one of these still, sunshiny March days that it occurred to the oldest boy of the household that it was about time for the sap to begin to run. He does not waste much time in making tracks for the shop, where he hunts up some old spouts and an auger. He will tap two or three of the trees near the house anyway. There is no lack of helpers. All the smaller children are on hand to watch and advise him, and to fetch pans from the house and prop them up under the spouts. They watch eagerly for the appearance of the first drops, and when they sight them, each tells the rest that,
"There they are, and it does run!"
And they want their older brother to stop his boring at the next tree and come and look. But William feels that he is too old to show enthusiasm about such things, and he simply tells them that he guesses that he's seen sap for now. The children take turns applying their mouths to the end of the spout number one to catch the first drops that trickle down it. In days following, there are frequent visitors to these tapped trees, with the avowed purpose of seeing how the sap is running, but it is to be noticed that at the same time they seem always to find it convenient to take a drink from a pan. In the more hilly regions of New England, most of the farms have a sugar orchard on them, and the tree tapping that begins about the house is soon transferred to the woods. The boy goes along too, indeed. What work is there about a farm that he does not have a hand in, either of his own will or because he has to? But the phase I wish now to speak of is that found on the farms that possess no maple orchard. The boy sees that the trees about the house are attended to, as a matter of course, and he guards the pans and warns off the neighbor's boys when he thinks they are making too free with the pan's contents. Each morning he goes out with a pail, gathers the sap, and sets it boiling in a kettle on the stove. In time comes the final triumph, when some morning the family leaves the molasses pot in the cupboard, and they have maple syrup on their griddle cakes. It is not every boy whose enterprise stops with the tapping of the shade trees in front of the house. On many farms there is an occasional maple about the fields, and sometimes there are a few in a patch of near woodland. In such a case, the boy gathers a lot of elder stalks while it is still winter, cleans out the pith, and shapes them into spouts. At the first approach of mild weather, he taps the scattered trees and distributes among them every receptacle the house affords that does not leak, or whose leaks can be soldered or beeswaxed to catch the sap. After that, while the season lasts, he and his brother swing a heavy tin can on a staff between them and make the periodical tours sap collecting. These frequent tramps through mud and snow in all kinds of weather soon become monotonously wearisome, and the boys usually find one season of this kind of experience enough. With the going of the snow comes a mud spell that lasts fully a month. It takes you forever to drive anywhere with the team. It is drag, 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 and slop, slop, slop all the way. Even the home dooryard is little better than a bog, and the boy can never seem to step out anywhere without coming in loaded with mud. At least so his mother says. She has continually to be warning him to keep out of the sting room, and at times seems to be thrown into as much consternation over some of his footprints that she finds on the kitchen floor, as was Robinson Crusoe over the discovery of that lone footprint in the sand. Just as soon as she hears the boys shuffle on the piazza and catches sight of him coming in at the kitchen door, she says, "There, Willie, don't you come in till you wipe your feet." "I have," says Willie. "Why, just look at them," his mother responds. "I should think you'd got about all the mud there was in the yard on 'em." "I never saw such sticky old stuff," says Willie. "Your broom's most wore out already." "Well," remarked his mother, "what are you getting into the mud for all over that way every time you step out? Pa's laid down boards all around the yard to walk on. Why don't you go on them?" "They ain't laid where I want to go," replies Willie. "Anyway," is his mother's final remark, "I can't have my kitchen floor mussed up by you tracking in every 5 minutes." But the really severe experiences in this line come when the barnyard is cleaned out. For several days the boy's shoes are a sight, and his journeyings are accompanied with such an odor that his mother warns him off entirely from her domains. He's not allowed to walk in and get that piece of pie for his lunch, but has it handed out to him through the narrowly opened kitchen door. When mealtime comes, he has to leave his shoes and overalls in the woodshed and comes into the house in his stocking feet. Even then his mother makes derogatory remarks, though he tells her he can't smell anything. It is astonishing how quickly, after the snow goes, the green will clothe the fields, and how with bursting buds and the first blossoms, all nature seems teeming with life again. I think the sentiment of the boy is touched by this season more than by any other. The unfolding of all this new life is full of mysterious charm. It is a delight to tread the velvety turf, to find the first flowers, to catch the oft-repeated sweetness of a phoebe's song, or the more forceful trilling of a robin at sundown. It is at nightfall that spring appeals to the boy most strongly. He can still feel the heat of the sun when it lingers at the horizon, and in the gentle warmth of its rays enjoys a run about the yard, and claps at the little clouds of midges that are sporting in the air. As soon as the sun disappears, there is a gathering of cool evening damps, and from the swampy hollows come many strange pipings and croakings. The boy wonders vaguely about all the creatures that make these noises, and imitates their voices from the home lawn. When the dusk begins to deepen into darkness, he is glad to get into the light and warmth of the kitchen. To tell the truth, our boy is rather afraid of the dark. Just what he fears is but dimly defined, though bears, thieves, and Indians are among the fearsome shades that people the night glooms. It does not take much of a noise, when he is out alone in the dark, to set his heart thumping, and his imagination pictures dreadful possibilities in the shapes and movements that greet his eyesight. This fear is not confined to out of doors. He has a notion that there may be a lurking savage in the pantry or the cellar, or the dusky corners of the hallways, or, worst of all, under his bed. Those fears are most vivid after he has been reading some tale of desperate adventure, or of mystery, dark doings, and evil characters. Very good books and papers often have in them the elements that produce these scary effects. These are the sources of his timidity, for dime novel trash, although not altogether absent, is not common in the country. The boy does not usually acquire much of his fear from the talk of his fellows, and his parents certainly do not foster such feelings. It is undoubtedly his reading mainly. He rarely feels fear if he has company, or if he is where there is light, or after he gets into bed, that is, unless there are noises. What makes these noises you hear sometimes in the night? You certainly don't hear such noises in the daytime. The boy does not mind rats. He knows them. They can race through the walls and grit their teeth on the plastering and throw all those bricks and things, whatever they are, down inside there that they want to. But it's these creakings and crackings and softer noises that you can't tell what they are that are the trouble. The very best you can do is pull the covers up over your head and shiver into sleep again. But if the boy has frights, they are intermittent, for the most part, and soon forgotten. With the thawing of the snow on the hills and the early rains comes, each spring, a time of flood on all the brooks and rivers, that no one appreciates more than the boy who is so fortunate as to have a home on their banks. Water in whatever shape possesses a fascination for the boy, if we accept that for washing purposes. It does not matter whether it is a dirty puddle or a sparkling brook or the spurting jet at the highway watering trough. He wants to paddle and splash in everyone. He even sees a touch of the beautiful and sublime in water in some of its effects. There is a charm to him in the placid pond that mirrors every object along its banks, or on brisker days in the choppy waves that break the surface and curl up on the muddy shore. He likes to follow the course of a brook, and takes pleasure in noting the clearness of its waters and in watching its crystal leaps. When spring changes the quiet streams into muddy torrents, and they become foaming and wild and unfamiliar, the boy finds the sight impressive and exhilarating. But it is on the larger rivers that the floods have most meaning. The water sets back in all the hollows and broadens into wide lakes on the meadows and covers portions of the main road. The boy cuts a notch in a stick and sets his mark at the water's edge, that he may keep posted as to how fast the river is rising. He gets out the spike pole and fishes out the floodwood that floats within reach. If he is old enough to manage a boat, he rows out into the stream and hitches on to an occasional log or large stick that is sailing along on the swift current. For this purpose, if he is alone, he has an iron hook fastened at the back end of the boat that he pounds into the log. It is hard, jerky work towing a log to shore, and he does not always succeed in landing his capture. Sometimes the hook will keep pulling out. Sometimes the thing he hitches on to is too bulky or clumsy, and after a long, hard pull, panting and exhausted, he finds himself getting so far downstream that he reluctantly knocks out the hook, rows inshore, and creeps in the eddies along the bank back to his starting place. There is just one trouble about this catching floodwood. It increases the wood pile materially and makes a lot of work, sawing and chopping, that the boy has little fancy for. In early spring, there is sometimes a long, continued spell of dry weather. In the woods, the trees are still bare, and the sunlight has free access to the leaf-carpeted earth. At such a time, if a fire gets started among the shriveled and tinder-like leaves, it is no easy task to put it out. Whole neighborhoods turn out to fight it, and several days and nights may pass before it is under control. The boy is among the first on the spot with his hoe, and immediately begins a vigorous scratching to clear a path in the leaves that the fire will not burn across. The company scatters, and sometimes the boy finds himself alone. Close in front, extending away in both directions, is the ragged fire line leaping and crackling. The woods are still, the sun shines bright, and there is a sense of mystery and danger in the presence of those sullen, devouring flames. Now comes a puff of wind that causes the fire to make a sudden dash forward and shrouds the boy with smoke. He runs back to a point of safety and listens to the far-off shouts of the men. The fire is across the path he hoed, and he picks up a piece of birch to eat while he clambers up the hill to find company. When night comes, the boy wanders off home to do his work and eat supper. If he is allowed, he is out again with his hoe in the evening. The scene is full of a wild charm. From the somberness of the unburned tracks, you look into the hot, wavering line of dazzling flames, and on into regions where linger many sparkling embers which the fire has not yet burned out, and now and then there is a pile of wood, that is a great mass of glowing coals, and again the high stump of some dead tree that burns like a torch in the blackness. The boy thinks the men do more talking and advising than work. He does not accomplish much himself. The men keep together, and he hangs about the dark, half-lighted groups, listens to what is said, and with the others does some desultory scratching to keep the fire from gaining new ground at the point they are guarding. By and by there comes a man hallooing his way through the woods to them, who has brought a milk can full of coffee. Every man and boy takes a drink, and they all crack jokes and exchange opinions with the bearer till he starts off to find the next group. Some of the men stay on guard all night, but the boy and his father, about 10 o'clock, leave the crackle and darting of the flames behind them, and take a gloomy wood road that leads toward home. There has been nothing very alarming in the day's adventures, but the boy never forgets the experience. Fire is fascinating to the boy in any form. He burned his fingers at the stove damper when he was a baby. He likes to look at the glow of a lamp, and a candle with its soft flicker and halo is especially pleasing. Then those new matches his folks have got that go off with a snap and burst at once into a sudden blaze. He has never seen anything like them. They remind him of the delights of 4th of July. The chief event of the spring is a bonfire in the garden. There is an accumulation of dead vines, an old pea brush, and apple tree trimmings that often make a large heap. The fire is enjoyable at whatever time it comes, but it is at its best if they touch it off in the evening. The whole family comes out to see it then, and Frank fixes up a seat for his mother and the baby out of a board and some blocks, and invites some of the neighbor's boys to be on hand. He puts an armful of leaves under a corner of the pile and sets it going with some of those parlor matches. The neighbor's boys stand around and tell him how, and even offer to do it themselves. When the blaze fairly starts and begins to trickle up through the twigs above it, the smaller children jump for joy and clap their hands, and run to get handfuls of leaves and scattered rubbish to throw on. Frank pokes the pile this way and that with his pitchfork, and the neighbor's boys light the ends of long sticks and wave them about in the air. Even the baby coos with delight. The father has a rake and does most of the work that is really necessary, while the boys furnish all the action and noise needful to make the occasion a success. When the blaze is at its highest and the heat penetrates far back, the company becomes quiet, and they stand about exchanging occasional words and simply watching the flames lick up the brush and flash upward and disappear amid the smoke and sparks that rise high toward the dark deeps of the sky. The frolic is resumed when the pile of brush begins to fall inward, and presently mother says she and the baby and the smallest children must go in. The latter protest, but they have to go, and not long after the embers of the fire are all raked together, and Frank and the neighbor's boys fool around a little longer, and get about a half dozen final warming-ups, and then tramp off homeward in whistling happiness. On the day following, the garden is ploughed and harrowed. Then the boy has to help scratch it over and even it off with a rake, and is kept on the jump all the time getting out seeds and planters and tools that never seem to be in the right place at the right time. Meanwhile, he induces his father to let him have a corner of the garden for his own, and gets his advice as to what he had best put in it to make his fortune. He scratches over the plot about twice as fine as the rest of the garden, and won't let any of the old hens that are hanging around looking for worms come near it. He has concluded that peas are the things to bring in money, but he is tempted to try 3 or 4 hills of potatoes between the rows after he has the peas in. He has saved space for a hill of watermelons, and just to fill up the blanks, which seem rather large with nothing yet up, he puts in, as a matter of experiment, a number of other seeds here and there of one sort and another. He puts these in from time to time, along when it comes handy and a thought occurs to him. He was somewhat astonished at the way things came up. Indeed, he thought they would never get done coming up, and they were pretty well mixed up in their arrangement. He got so discouraged over the things that kept sprouting in one corner that he hoed the whole thing up on that spot and transplanted a few cabbages on it. He used to get his mother to come out and look at his garden patch, and he enjoyed telling her his plans. But he left that off for a while when the things became so erratic, and waited till he could thin them out and bring their proceedings within his comprehension. It is in spring, more than any other season, that the boy's ideas bud with new enterprises. He forgets most of them by the time he has them fairly started, and none of them are apt to have any pecuniary value. But that never damps his enthusiasm in rushing into new ones. The hunting fever is apt to take him pretty soon after the snow goes, and he makes a bow and whittles out some arrows and turns Indian. He may even visit the resorts of the hens and collect enough feathers to make a circlet to wear around his head. Then he goes off and hunts bears and things, and scalps the neighbor's boys. Sometimes, instead of being an Indian, he gets his father to saw out a wooden gun and turns pioneer. Then savages and wild animals both have to catch it. He will skulk around in the most approved fashion and say, "Bang!" for his gun every time he fires, and he will like enough kill 60 Indians and 12 grizzly bears in one forenoon. He is fearless, as you please, until night comes. Not all the boys' hunting is so mild as to stop at the killing off of bears and Indians. Sometimes he shoots his arrows at real, live things, or he has a rubber sling, or he practices throwing stones, and does not resist the temptation to make the birds and squirrels and possibly the cats and the chickens his marks. It is true he rarely hits any of them, and the sensitive boy, if he seriously hurts one of the creatures fired at, has a twinge of remorse. But there are those who will only glory in the straightness of their aim. There is something of the savage still in their nature, and they feel a sense of prowess and power in bringing down that which, in spite of its life and movement, did not escape them. It is to them a much grander and more enjoyable thing than to hit a lifeless and unmoving mark. The boys, at any rate many of them, are at times, in a thoughtless way, downright cruel. See how they will bang about the old horse upon occasion. They have no compunctions about drowning a cat or wringing the neck of a chicken, and will run 50 miles to be present at a hog-killing. They have barely a grain of sympathy for the worm they impale on their fish-hooks. They will kill the grasshopper who will not give them molasses. They crush the butterfly's wings in catching it with their straw hats, and they pull off insects' limbs to see them wriggle, or to find out how the insect will get along without them. I will not extend the horrible list, and I am not sure that most boys would be guiltless of the majority of these charges. However, they are much too apt to play the part of the destroyers. This spirit is shown in the way the boy will whip off the heads of flowers along his path, if he has a stick in his hand, and the manner in which he gathers them when gathering happens to be his purpose. He never thinks of their life or of their beauty, where they stand, or of the future. He picks them all, snaps off the heads, pulls them up by the roots, any way to get the whole thing in the shortest possible time. If the boy was as thorough as he's rootless, you could never find more flowers of the same sort on that spot. This does not argue a total disregard for the flowers, but it is a pity to love a thing to destruction. The first token of spring in the flower line that the boy brings into the house is probably a sprig of pussy willow. The fuzzy catkins are to his mind very odd and interesting and pretty. The ground is still snow-covered, and they have started with the first real thaw. Before the pastures get their first green, the boy goes off to find the new arbutus buds that smell sweetest of all the flowers he knows, unless it may be honeysuckle. That comes later. Already by the brook are the queer skunk cabbage blossoms, and the boy sometimes pulls one to pieces and even sniffs the odor just to learn how bad it really is. He may find a stout, short-stemmed dandelion thus early open in some warm grassy hollow, and a few days later the anemone's dainty cups are out in full and trembling on their slender stems with every breath of air. In pasture bogs and along the brooks are violets, mostly blue, but in places there are yellow and white ones, ready to delight their finder. The higher and drier slopes of the pastures are in spots sometimes almost blue with the coarse birdfoot violets, while lower down the ground is as white with the multitudes of innocents, as if there had been a light snowfall. Along the roadways and fences the wild cherry trees are clouded full of white petals, and in the woods are great dashes of white where the dogwoods have unfurled their blossoms. By the end of May the meadows are like a night sky full of stars, so thick are the dandelions, and on the rocks of the hillside the columbines sway, full of their oddly shaped pendulous bells. In some damp wood path The boy is filled with rejoicing by the finding of one of the rare lady slippers where he has been gathering wake-robin. The only other spring flower I will mention as of special interest to the boy is the jack-in-the-pulpit, and that hardly seems a flower to him, it is so queer. Spring has 3 days with an individuality that makes him stand out among the rest. The 1st of April is April Fool's Day. The only idea the boy has about it, that the more things he can make the rest of the world think on that day are not so, the better. It has to be acknowledged that most of the tricks are not very clever or commendable, and the boy himself feels that he is sometimes getting uncomfortably close to lying. The common form of fooling is to get a person to look at something that is not in sight. "See that crow out there?" says the boy to his father. "Where?" asks his father when he looks out. "April fools!" shouts the boy, and he is pleased with the slick way he fooled his pa. For about half an hour, when he discovers that he has been walking around for he doesn't know how long with a slip of paper on his back that his sister pinned there, and what he reads on it when he gets it off is, "April fool." He does not feel so happy then, but he saves the paper to pin on someone else. All day his brain is full of schemes to get people looking at the imaginary objects he calls their attention to, and at the same time he is full of suspicions himself, and you have to be very sharp and sudden to fool him. When night comes he rejoices in the fact that he has got one or two fools off on every member of the family, and there is no knowing what a nuisance he has made of himself among the rest of his friends. It gives him a grand good appetite, and he feels inclined to be quite conversational. His remarks, however, assume a milder tenor when he bites into a portly doughnut and finds it made of cotton. He is afraid his mother is trying to fool him. He wouldn't have thought it of her. Soon after this day comes fast day. School's let out, and there's meeting at the church. But most folks do not pay much attention to that, and it being a holiday, they eat rather more than on other days, if anything, and they joke about it being fast in the sense that it is not slow. Our boy does what work he has to do, and then asks the privilege of going off to see some other boy and have some fun. However, that is the thing that happens on all sorts of days. He is always ready with that request when he has leisure, and makes it oftentimes too, when he has no leisure in anyone's opinion but his own. The 30th of May is Decoration Day, and a company of soldiers will come with a band and flags and will decorate the graves of the soldiers in the little cemetery, and there will be singing and other exercises, and everybody will be there. The boy has his bouquet, and he is on the spot promptly and chatting with some of his companions. It may be the quiet of the early morning that is the appointed time. There are lines of teams hitched along the roadside, and two or three score of waiting people have gathered near the entrance. The occasion has something of the solemnity of a funeral, and even the boys lower their voices as they talk. The sound of a drum and fife is heard around the turn of the road. The soldiers, under their drooping flag, approach and file into the cemetery. A song, an address, and a prayer follow, all very impressive to the boy, out there under the skies with the wide blossoming landscape about. Finally, he lays his flowers with the others on the graves. The soldiers form in line, the fife pipes once more, the drum beats, and off they go down the road. Then the people begin a more cheerful visiting, and there is a cramping of wheels as the teams turn to go homeward. The boy with his friends pokes about among some of the old stones, and then lingers along in the rear of the scattered groups that are taking the road that leads to the village. End of Part 2. Spring. Read for you by Chiquito Crasto, Birmingham, Alabama. Part 3 of The Farmer's Boy by Clifton Johnson. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Read for you by Chiquito Crasto. Part 3. Summer. The boy feels that summer has really come about the time he gets a new straw hat and begins to go barefoot. When he first gets on the earth without shoes and stockings, he is as frisky as are the cows when, after the winter sojourn in the barn, they are let out to go to pasture for the first time. The boy remembers very well how he nearly ran his legs off on that occasion, for the cows wanted to career all through the neighborhood, and they kicked and capered and ran and hoisted their tails in the air, and were as bad as a circus broke loose. The boy would have gone barefoot some weeks before, only he could not get his mother to understand how warm the earth really was. It is cooler now than he thought, but he gets into a glow running, and in a few days the exposure toughens his feet, so that he can stand almost anything, anything but shoes and stockings. He hates to put those uncomfortable things on, and when he does, is glad to kick them off at the earliest opportunity. Even the first frosts of autumn do not at once bring the shoes out. He will drive the cows up the whitened lane, and slip shivering along in the tracks brushed half clear of the frost by the herd, certain that he will be entirely comfortable a little later when the sun gets well up. But the joy of bare feet is not altogether complete, even in summer. About half the time the boy goes with a limp. He has hurt his toe, cut his heel, or met with some like mishap. There is something always lying around for him to step on, and in the late summer certain wicked burrs ripen in the meadow that have hooks to their prickles, that hurt enough going in, but are, oh, so much worse pulling out. The boy never likes to walk on newly mown land on account of the stiff grass stubs that cover it. Yet he can manage pretty well by sliding his feet along and making the stubble lie flat when he steps on it. However, the gains of bare feet certainly much more than offset the losses to his mind, for he can tramp and wade almost everywhere and in all kinds of weather with no fear of tearing his stockings, muddying his shoes, or getting his feet wet. He appreciates this going barefoot most, perhaps after a rainstorm. You have no idea, unless you have been a boy yourself, what fun it is to slide and spatter through the pools and puddles of the roadway. There is the boy's mother, for instance. She fails to have the mildest kind of appreciation of it. She has even less, if that is possible, when the boy comes in to her after he has astonished himself by a sudden slip that seats him in the middle of one of these puddles. When the air after a storm is very still, the boy is sometimes impressed by the apparent depth of these shallow pools. They seem to go down miles and miles, and he can see the clouds and sky reflected in their clear deeps. He is half inclined to keep away from their edges, lest he should fall over and go down and down till he was drowned among those far-off cloud reflections. Another roadway sentiment the boy sometimes entertains is connected with the ridges of dirt thrown up by the wagon wheels. Their shadows make pictures to him as of a great line of jagged rocks, like the wild coast of Norway in his geography. He feels like an explorer as he follows the ever-changing craggedness of their outlines. I mentioned that the boy had a new straw hat with the beginning of summer. You would not think it 2 days afterward. It had by then lost its store manner and had taken to itself an individual shape all its own. It did not take long for the ribbon to begin to fly loose off the breezes, and then the colt took a bite out of the edge, and a general dissolution set in. The boy used it to chase grasshoppers and butterflies with, and one day he brought it home half full of strawberries he had picked in a field. On another occasion he utilized it to catch pollywogs in when he was wading, and he hastened its ruin by using it as a ball on summer evenings to throw it in the air. He thought one night he had put it past all usefulness when, not thinking where he had placed it, he went and sat down in the chair where it was. You would not have known it for a hat when he picked it up, though he straightened it out after a fashion and concluded it would serve for a while longer anyway. But things presently got to that desperate pass where the brim was gone and there was a bristly hole in the top, and the folks saw the hat could not possibly last the summer through, and the next time his father went to town he bought the boy a new one. Of course, he told him to be more careful with this than with the old one when he gave it to him. The summer was not far advanced when the boy became anxious as to whether the water had warmed up enough in the streams to make it allowable to go in swimming. As for the little rivers among the hills, they never did get warmed up, and in the hottest spells of midsummer it made the boy's teeth chatter to jump into their cold pools. But there was a glowing reaction after the plunge, and if he did not stay in too long, he came out quite enlivened by his bath. The bathing places on those woodland streams are often quite picturesque. It may be a spot where the stream widens into a little pond hemmed in by walls of green foliage, whose branches and places droop far out over the water. It may be in a rocky gorge strewn with boulders, where the stream fills the air with a continual roar and murmur as it dashes down the rapids and plunges from pool to pool. On the large rivers of the valleys, the swimming places have usually muddy shores
and a willow-screened bank, and there are logs to float on or an old boat to push about. In favorable weather, the boys will go in swimming every evening, and they make the air resound for half a mile about with their shouts and splashings. June comes in with lots of work in the planting line. The boy has to drop fertilizer and drop potatoes some days from morning till night, by which time he is ready to drop himself. In corn planting, he has his own bag of tarred corn and his hoe, and takes the row next to his father's. For a spell he may keep up with the rest, but as the day advances he lags behind, and his father plants a few hills occasionally on the boy's row to encourage him. One of the things a boy soon becomes an adept at is leaning on his hoe. He naturally does this most when he is alone in the field, and not liable to sudden interruptions in his meditations. At such times he gets lonesome and has that tired feeling, and gets to wondering why the dinner horn doesn't blow. You would not think a hoe an easy thing to lean on, but the boy will stand on one leg, with the hoe handle hooked under his shoulder, for any length of time. The corn is no sooner in the ground than the crows begin to happen around to investigate. They will pull it even after it gets an inch or two high, and snap off the kernel at the roots, and it seems sometimes as if they rather like the flavor of the tar put on to destroy their appetite. The boy's indignation waxes high, and he wishes he had a gun or a pistol or something to fix those old crows. His mother does not like firearms. She is afraid he will shoot himself, but she gives him some old clothes, and he goes off to the shop to tack a scarecrow together and stuff him with hay. When his father appears and pretends to be scared by the scarecrow's terrible figure, the boy is quite elated. After supper, he and his mother and the smaller children go out in the field and set the man up, and the boy shakes hands with him and holds a little conversation with him. His small brothers and sisters are sure the crows won't dast to come around there any more, and they are kind of scared of the old scarecrow themselves. The days wax hotter and hotter as the season advances, and the boy presently gets down to the simplest elements in the clothing line. Indeed, if his folks do not insist on something more elaborate, he goes about entirely content in a shirt and a pair of overalls. His hair is apt to grow rather long between the cuttings his mother gives it, and about this time he looks up an uncle or a cousin who is an adept in the hair-cutting line, and gets a tight clip that leaves him as bald as his most ancient ancestor. He feels delightfully cool anyway, and looks don't count much with him at that age. As soon as the first ploughing was done in the spring, the onions were sowed. Their little green needles soon prickled up through the ground, and now they had the company of a multitude of weeds, and must be hoed and weeded out. One thing the boy never quite gets to understand is the curious facts that weeds, at first start, will grow twice as fast as any useful crop. He wishes weeds had some value. All you'd have to do would be to let them grow. They take care of themselves. In the case of the onions, the hoeing out part is not very bad. But when you get down on your hands and knees to scratch the weeds out of the rows with your fingers, your trouble begins. The boy says his back aches. His father comforts him by telling him that he guesses not, that he's too young to have the backache, that he'd better wait till he's 50 or 60, and his joints get stiff and he has the rheumatism, then he'll have something to talk about. But the boy knows very well that his back does ache, and the sun is as hot again as it was when he was standing up, and his head feels as if it were going to drop off. He gets up once in a while to stretch and to see if there are any signs of his mother's wanting him at the house, or hens around that ought to be chased off, or anything else going on that will give him a chance for a change. He bends to his work again presently, and tries various changes from plain stoop, such as one knee down, and the other raised to support his chest, or a sit-down in the row, and an attempt to weed backward. When left to himself, he takes long rests at the end of the rows, lying in the grass on his back under the shadow of an apple tree, or he gets thirsty and goes in the house for a drink. He is afflicted with thirst a great deal when he is weeding onions, and gets cook-hungry remarkably often too. His most agreeable respite while weeding occurs when he discovers that the neighbor's boy has come out and is at work just over the fence. He throws a lump of dirt at him to attract his attention, and then they exchange hellos. They soon come together and lean on the fence and compare gardens, and likely enough get to boasting and on the borders of a quarrel before they are through. Our boy goes back to work in time, and his aches are not so severe afterward, at least so long as he has the neighbor's boy over the fence to call at. When the boy's father goes away from home to be gone all day, he is apt to set the boy a stent. "You put into it now," he says, "and hoe those 18 rows of corn, and then you can play the rest of the day. The boy is inclined to be dubious when he contemplates his task. It doesn't look to him as if he could get it done in the whole day, but he makes a start and concludes it is not so bad after all. He keeps at work with considerable perseverance, and only stops to sit on the fence for a little while at the end of every other row, and wants to go up the lane to pick a few raspberries that have turned almost black. As the rows dwindle, he becomes increasingly exuberant, and whistles all through the last one. And when that is done, and he puts his hoe over his shoulder and marches home, he has not a care in the world. He made up his mind early in the day that he would go fishing when he was free, and now he digs some worms back of the shop, gets out his pole, and hunts up his best friend. The best friend is watering tobacco. He can't go just then, but if Tommy will pitch in and help him for about 15 minutes, he'll have that job done and will be with him. The boys make the water fly, and it is not long before they and their poles and their thin bait box are at the riverside. The water just dimples in the light breeze. The warm afternoon sunlight shines in the boys' faces and glitters on the ripples. They conclude, after a little while, that it is not a good afternoon for fishing, and think wading will prove more profitable. As a result, they get their pants wet and their jackets splattered, though where on earth all that water came from they can't make out. They thought they were careful. They are afraid their mothers will make some unpleasant remarks when they get home. It seems best they should roll down their trousers and give them a chance to dry a little before they have to leave. Meanwhile, they do not suffer for lack of amusement, for they find a lot of rubbish to throw into the water, and some flat stones to skip, and some lucky bugs to catch, and lastly, Charlie Thompson's spotted dog shows himself on the bank, and they entice him down to the shore and take to wading again, and have great fun, and get wetter than ever. As they walk home, Tommy said, "Let's go fishing again some day," and Sammy agreed without any hesitation. They caught not even a shiner this time, but on some occasions they brought home a perch or two, and a bullhead and a sucker strung on a willow twig. Rainy days were those on which they were freest to go fishing, and on such days the fish were supposed to bite best. The boy seemed perfectly willing to don an old coat and an old felt hat, and spend a whole drizzling morning at almost any time slopping along the muddy margin of the river. No one could accuse him of being over fastidious. At some time in his career, the boy was pretty sure to bring home a live fish in his tin lunch-pail, and turn him loose in the water-tub at the barn, and he might catch a dozen or so minnows in a pool left landlocked by a fall of the water, and put those in. He would see them chasing around in there, and the old big fish lurking very solemn in the darkest depths, and he fed them bits of bread and worms, and planned for them a very happy and comfortable life, till they should be grown up, and he was ready to eat them. But they disappeared in time, and there was not one left. The boy had an idea, they must have eaten each other, and then the cow swallowed the last one. If it wasn't that, what was it? In the early summer, strawberries are ripe. They are the first berries to come that amount to anything. You can pick a few wintergreen and partridge berries on the hillsides in spring, but those hardly count. The boy always knows spots on the farm where the strawberries grow wild, and when, some early morning, he goes up with the cows and is late to breakfast, it proves he has been tramping in the pasture after berries. He has pushed out among the dew-laden tangles of the grass until he is as wet as if he had been in the river, but he is in a glowing triumph on his return over the red clusters he pulls from his hat to display to the family. Probably some farmer in the neighborhood raises strawberries for market and pays 2 cents a quart for picking. If so, the boy cannot rest easy till his folks agree to let him improve his chances to gain pocket money, which is a thing he never fails to be short of. He will get up at 3 o'clock in the morning and carry his breakfast with him in order to be on hand with the rest of the children on the field at daybreak. His eagerness cools off in a few days, and it is only with the greatest difficulty that the employer can get his youthful help to stick to the work through the season. They have eaten the berries till they are sick of them, they are tired of stooping, and they have earned so much that their longings for wealth are satisfied. They are apt to get to squabbling about rows while picking, and to enliven the work on dull days by sassing one another. The proper position for picking is a stooping posture, but when the boy comes home, you can see by the spotted pattern on the knees and seat of his trousers that he has made some sacrifices to comfort. The proprietor of the berry fields and all concerned are glad when they get to the end of the season. When the boy got up those early June mornings, he was in time to hear their air full of bird songs, as it would be at no other time through the day. What made the birds so madly happy as soon as the east caught the first tints of the coming sun? The village trees seemed fairly alive with the songsters, and every bird was doing his best to outdo the rest. Most boys have not a very wide acquaintance with the birds, but there are certain ones that never fail to interest them. The boy's favorite is pretty sure to be the bobolink. He's such a happy fellow. He reels through the air in such delight over his singing and the sunny weather. How his song gurgles and glitters, how he swells out his throat, how prettily he balances and sways on the woody stem of some tall meadow flower. He has a beautiful coat of black and white, and the boy wonders at the rusty feathers of his mate, which looks like an entirely different bird. As the season advances, Bobolink changes, and not for the better. His handsome coat gets dingy, and he loses his former gaiety. He has forgotten almost altogether the notes of his earliest song of tumbling happiness, and croaks harshly as he stuffs himself on the seeds with which the fields now teem. Ease and high living seem to have spoiled his character, just as if he had been human. Before summer is done, the bobolinks gather in companies and wheel about the fields in little clouds preparatory to migrating. Sometimes the whole flock flies into some big tree, and from amid the foliage come scores of tinkling notes as of many tiny bells jingling. The boy sees no more of the bobolinks till they return in the spring to once more pour forth their overflowing joy on the blossom-scented air of the meadows. One of the other birds that the boy is familiar with is the lark, a coarse, large bird with two or three white feathers in its tail, but the lark is too sober to interest him much. Then there is the catbird, of sleek form and stately plumage, flitting and mewing among the shadows of the apple-tree boughs. The brisk robin, who always has a scared look and therefore is out of character as a robber, he knows very well. Robin builds a rough nest of straws and mud in the crotches of the fruit trees, and he has a habit of crying in sharp notes at sundown, as if he were afraid sorrow was coming to him in some shape. The robin has a caroling song too, but that the boy is not so sure of separating from the music of the other birds. He always knows the woodpeckers by their long bills and the way they trot up and down the tree trunks, bottom side up or anyhow. He knows the bluebird by its color, and the phoebe by its song. The orioles are not numerous enough for him to have much acquaintance with, but he is familiar with the dainty nest they swing far out on the tips of the branches of the big shade trees. He sees numbers of little birds when the cherries ripen, and the peapods fill out that are as bright as glints of golden sunlight. They vary in their tinting and size, but he calls them all yellow birds, and has a poor opinion of them, for he rarely sees them except when they are stealing. Along the water courses, he now and then glimpses a heavy-headed kingfisher sitting in solemn watchfulness on a limb, or making a startling headlong plunge into a pool. Along shore, the sandpipers run about in a nervous way on their thin legs, always teetering and complaining, and taking fright and flitting away like a shot at the least sound. On the borders of the ponds, the boy sometimes comes upon a crane or a blue heron meditating on one leg up to his knee in water. Off he goes in awkward flight, trailing his long legs behind him. On the ponds, too, the wild ducks alight in the fall and spring on their journeys south and north. There may be as many as 20 of the compact, glossy-backed creatures in a single flock, but a much smaller number is more common. The swallows on summer days are to be found skimming over the waters of the streams and ponds, and they make flying dips and twitter and rise and fall and twist and turn, and seem very happy. They have holes in a high bank in the vicinity, and if the boy thinks he wants to get a collection of bird eggs, he arms himself with a trowel, some day, and climbs the steep dirt bank to dig them out. The holes go in about an arm's length, and at the end is a rude little nest and some white eggs with such tender shells that the boy breaks many more than he succeeds in carrying away. He stores such eggs as he gathers from time to time in small wooden or pasteboard boxes with cotton in the bottoms until too many of them get broken, when he throws the whole thing away. His interest has been destructive and temporary, and he would much better have studied in a different fashion or turned his talents to something else. Several other birds are still to be mentioned that get his attention. There are the hummingbirds that are so small and that buzz out among the blossoms and prick them with their long bills and poise so still on their misty wings and have hues of rainbow in their feathers and flash out of sight across the yard in no time when they see you. There are the barn and chimney swallows that you notice most at twilight, darting in tangled flights in upper air or skimming low over the fields in twittering alertness. How they worry the old cat as she crouches in the hayfield! Again and again they almost touch her head in their circling, but they are so swift and changeful that the cat has no chance of catching them. Then there is the kingbird the boy very much admires. He is a vigorous, well-looking fellow, with an admirable antipathy for tyrants and bullies. Size makes no difference with him. He puts the crow to ungainly flight, he follows the hawk, and you can see him high in the air, darting down at the great bird's back again and again, and he does not even fear the eagle. In corn-planting time, the whippoorwill makes the evening air ring with his lonely calls, and the boy has sometimes seen his dusky form standing lengthwise on a fence-rail, just as he was about to flit far off across the fields and renew more distant by his whistling cry. The most distressing bird of all is the little screech owl. His tremulous and long-drawn wail suggests that someone human is out there in the orchard, crying out in his last feeble agonies. To put it mildly, the boy is scared when he hears the screech owl. The great and only holiday of the summer is 4th of July. The boy very likely does not know or especially care what the philosophic meaning of the day is. As he understands it, the occasion is one whose first requirement is a lot of noise. To furnish this in plenty, he is willing to begin the day by getting up at midnight to parade the village streets with the rest of the boys, and toot horns and set off firecrackers and liven up the sleepy occupants of the houses by making particular efforts before each dwelling. They have a care in their operations to be on guard, that they may hasten to a safe distance if anyone rushes out to lecture or chastise them. But if all continues quiet within doors, they will hoot and howl about for some time, and even blow up the mailbox with a cannon cracker, or commit other mild depredations to add to the glory of the occasion. When some particularly brilliant brain conceived the idea of getting all the boys to take hold of an old mowing machine and gallop it through the dark streets in full clatter, it may be supposed that the final touch was given to American independence and liberty. It was not all the boys that went roaming around thus, and it was the older and rougher ones who were the leaders. The smaller boys did not enter very heartily into all of the fun, though they dared not openly hang back, and when the stars paled and the first grey approach of dawn began to lighten the east, the little fellows felt very sleepy and lonely in spite of the company and noise. They were glad enough when, soon after, the band broke up and they could steal away home and go to bed. The day itself was enlivened by much popping of firecrackers and torpedoes in farm dooryards, by a village picnic in the afternoon, and by a grand setting off in the evening of pinwheels, Roman candles, a nigger chaser, and a rocket. After the rocket had gone up into the sky with its wild whir and its showering of sparks, and had toppled and burst and burned out into blackness, the day was ended, and the boy retired with the happiness that comes from labor done and duty well performed. The work of all others that fills the summer months is haying. In the hill towns the land is stony and steep, and much of it is cut over with scythes. But the majority of New England farmers do most of their grass-cutting with mowing machines. A boy will hardly do much of the actual mowing, in either case, until he is in his teens, but long before that he is called on to turn the grindstone, an operation that precedes the mowing of each fresh field. He gets pretty sick of that grindstone before the summer is through. He likes to follow after the mowing machine. There is something enlivening in its clatter, and he enjoys seeing the grass tumble backward as the darting knives strike their stalks. He does not care so much about following his father when he mows with a scythe, for then he is expected to carry a fork and spread the swath his father piles up behind him. On the little farms, machines are lacking to a degree, and the boys have to do much of the turning and raking by hand. Finally, they have to borrow a horse to get it in. The best-provided farmer usually does some borrowing, and there are those who are running all the time. That is, they keep the boy running. Boys are made for running. The boy does not like this job very well, for the lender is too often doubtful in his manner, if not in his words. On still summer days, the hayfield is apt to be a very hot place. The hay itself has a grey glisten, and the low-lying air shimmers with the heat. It is all very well if you can ride on the tedder or rake, but it makes the perspiration start if you have to do any work by hand. You do not have to be much of a boy to be called on by your father to rake up the scatterings back of the load, and you find you have to be on the jump all the time to keep up. If you can rake, you are large enough to be on the load and tread the hay into place as it is thrown up. It is not till you are pretty well grown that you have the strength to do the pitching on. Whatever the boy does in the field, in the barn, his place is up under the roof mowing away. The place is dusky, and the dust flies, and a cricket or some uncomfortable many-legged creature crawls down your back. It is hot and stifling, and the hay comes up about twice as fast as you want it. Before the load is quarter off, you begin to listen for the welcome scratch on your father's fork on the wagon rack that signals the nearing of the bottom of the load. Even then you have to creep all around under the eaves to tread the hay more solidly. You are glad enough when you can crawl down the ladder and go into the house and give your head a soak under the pump and get a drink of water. There's nothing tastes much better than water when you are dry that way, unless it is sweetened water that you take in a jug right down to the hayfield with you. I do not wish to give the impression that haying is made up too much of sweat and toil, and that the boy finds it altogether a season of trial and tribulation. It is not at all bad on cool days, and some boys like the jumping about on load and mow. There is fun in the jolting, rattling ride in the springless wagon to the hayfield, and when the haycocks in the orchard are rolled up for the night, the boys have great sport turning somersaults over them. Then there are exhilarating occasions when the sky blackens, and from the distant horizon comes the flashing and muttering of an approaching thunderstorm. Everybody does his best then. You race the horses, and the hay is rolled up and goes, forkful after forkful, twinkling up on the load in no time. But the storm is likely to come before you have done. There is a spattering of great drops that gives warning, and a dash of cold wind, and everybody, teams and all, will be seen racing helter-skelter to the barns. You are in luck if you get there before the whole air is filled with the flying drops. It is a pleasurable excitement anyway, and you feel very comfortable in spite of your wet clothes as you sit on the meal-chest talking with the others, listening to the rolling thunder and the rain rattling on the roof and splashing into the yard from the eaves spout. You look out of the big barn doors into the sheeted rain that veils the fields with its hurrying mists, and see its half-glooms lit up now and then by the shredded tatters. All nature glitters and drips and tinkles. The trees and fields have the freshness of spring. The tip of every leaf and every blade of grass twinkles with a diamond drop of water. The boy runs out with a shout to the roadside puddles. The chickens leave the shelter of the sheds and rejoice in the number of worms crawling about the hard-packed earth of the dooryard, and all kinds of birds begin singing in jubilee. But whatever incidental pleasure there may be in haying, it is generally considered a season of uncommonly hard work, and at its end the farm family thinks itself entitled to a picnic and a season of milder labor. The picnic idea usually develops into a plan to spend a whole day at some resort of picnickers where you have to pay 25 cents for admission, children half price. Of course, there are all sorts of ways that you can spend a good deal more than that at these places, but it is mostly the young men who feel called upon to demonstrate their fondness for the girls they have brought with them that patronize the extras. The farm family is economical. It carries feed for its horses and a big lunch basket packed full for itself, and simply goes in for all the things that are free, though Johnny and Tommy are allowed to draw on their meager supply of pocket money to the extent of 5 cents each for candy. There are swings to swing in and tables to eat on in a grove, and if it is by a lake or river, there are boats to row in and fish to catch, only you can't catch them. Meanwhile, the horses are tied conveniently in the woods and spend the day kicking and switching at the flies that happen around. Toward evening, the wagon is backed about and loaded up, the horses hitched up to it, and everybody piles in and noses are counted, and off they go homeward. The sun sets, the bright skies fade, and the stars sparkle out one by one, and look down on them as the horses jog along the glooms of the half-wooded, unfamiliar roadways. Some of the children get down under the seats and croon in a shaking gurgle as the wagon jolts their voices, and they shut their eyes and fancy the wagon is going backward, oh so swiftly. Then they open their eyes, and there are the tree leaves fluttering overhead, and the deep night sky above, and they see they are going on after all. When they near home, they all sit up on the seats once more and watch for familiar objects along the road. There is the house at last. The horses turn into the yard, they all alight, and in a few minutes a lamp is lighted in the kitchen. A neighbor has milked the cows. There are full pails on the bench in the back room. The children are so tired they can hardly keep their eyes open, but they must have a slice of bread and butter all around, and a piece of pie. Then, tired but happy, they bundle off to bed. Not every excursion of this kind is to a public pleasure resort. Sometimes the family goes after huckleberries or blackberries, or for a day's visit to relatives who live in a neighboring town, or to see a circus parade at the county seat. The family vehicle is apt to be the high, two-seated spring wagon. It is not particularly handsome to look at, but I fancy it holds more happiness than the gilded cars with their gaudy occupants that they see pass in the parade. The strawberries are the first heralds of a summer full of good things to eat. The boy begins sampling each in turn, as soon as they show signs of ripening, and on farms where children are numerous and fruits are not, very few things ever get ripe. You would not think to look at him that a small boy could eat as much as he can. He will be chewing on something all the morning, and have just as good an appetite for dinner as ever. In the afternoon he will eat 17 green apples, and be on hand for supper as lively as a cricket. Still, there are times when he repents his eating indiscretion in sackcloth and ashes. There is a point in the green apple line beyond which even the small boy cannot safely go. The twisting pains get hold of his stomach, and he has to go to his mother and get her to do something to keep him in the land of the living. He repents of all his misdeeds while the pain is on him, just as he would in a thunderstorm in the night that waked and scared him, and he says his prayers, and hopes, after all, if these are his last days, he has not been so bad, but that he will go to the good place. When he gets better, however, he forgets these vows and does much more things to repent. But that is not peculiarly a boyish trait. Grown-up people do that. End of Part 3, Summer. Read for you by Chiquito Crasto, Birmingham, Alabama. Part 4 of The Farmer's Boy by Clifton Johnson. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Read for you by Chiquito Crasto. Part 4, Autumn. By September, you begin to find dashes of color among the upland trees. It is some weakling bush, perhaps so poorly nourished, or by chance injured, that it must shorten its year and burn out thus early its meager foliage. But as soon as you see these pale flames among the greens, you feel that the year has passed its prime. Grown people may experience a touch of melancholy with the approach of autumn. The years fly fast. Another of those allotted them is almost gone. The brightening foliage is a presage of bare twigs, of frost and frozen earth, and the gales and snows of winter. This is not the boy's view. He is not retrospective. His interests are bound up in the present and the future. There is a good deal of unconscious wisdom in this mental attitude. He looks forward, whatever the time of year, with unflagging enthusiasm to the days approaching, and he rejoices in what he sees and experiences, for what these things then are, and does not worry himself with allegories. The bright-leaved tree at the end of summer is a matter of interest both for its brightness and its unexpectedness. The boy will pick a branch and take it home to show his mother, and the next day he will carry it to school and give it to the teacher. He would be glad to share all the good things of life that come to him with his teacher. Next to his mother, she is the best person he knows of. He never finds anything in his wanderings about home or in the fields or woods that is curious or beautiful or good to eat, but that the thought of the teacher flashes into his mind. His intentions are better than his ability to carry them out, for he often forgets himself and eats all the berries he picked on the way home, or he gets tired and throws away the treasures he has gathered. But what he does take to the teacher is sure of a welcome and an interest that makes him happy, and more her faithful follower than ever. Summer merges so gently into autumn that it is hard to tell where to draw the line of separation. September, as a rule, is a month of mild days mingled with some that have all the heat of midsummer, but the nights are cooler, and the dew feels icy cold to the boy's bare feet at times on his morning trips to and from pasture. Yet if you notice the fields closely, you will see that many changes are coming in to mark the season. The meadows are being clipped of their second crop of grass. The potato tops have withered and lost themselves in the motley masses of green weeds that continue to flourish after they have ripened. The loaded apple trees droop their branches and sprinkle the earth with early fallen fruit. The coarse grasses and woody creepers along the fences turn russet and crimson, and the garden becomes increasingly ragged and forlorn. The garden reached its fullness and began to go to pieces in July. First among its summer treasures came a green cucumber, then peas and sweet corn, and string beans and early potatoes. The boy had a great deal more to do with these things than he liked, for the gathering of them was among those small jobs it is so handy to call on the boy to do. However, he got not a little consolation out of it by eating of the things he gathered. Raw string beans were not at all bad, and a pod full of peas made a pleasant and juicy mouthful, while a small ear of sweet corn or a stalk of rhubarb or an onion, and even a green cucumber, could be used to vary the bill of fare. Along one side of the garden was a row of currant bushes. He was supposed to let those mostly alone. As his mother had warned him, she wanted them for jelly. But he did not interpret her warning so literally, but that he allowed himself to rejoice his palate with an occasional full cluster. It was when the tomatoes ripened that the garden reached the top notch in its offering of raw delicacies. Those red, full-skinned trophies fairly melted in the boy's mouth. He liked them better than green apples. The potatoes were the hardest things to manage of all the garden vegetables he was sent out to gather for dinner. His folks had an idea that you could dig into the sides of the hills and pull out the big potatoes, and then cover up and let the rest keep on growing. But when the boy tried this and had done with a hill, he had to acknowledge that it didn't look as if it would ever amount to much afterward. The sweet corn stalks from which the ears were picked had to be cut from time to time and fed to the cows. It was this thinning out of the corn, as much as the withering of the pea and cucumber vines and irregular digging of the potatoes, that gave the garden its early forlornness. By August, the pasture grass had been cropped short by the cows, and the drier slopes had withered into brown. Thenceforth it was deemed necessary to furnish the cows extra feed from other sources of supply. The farmer would mow with his scythe on many evenings in the nooks and corners about his buildings or along the roadside and in the lanes, and the results of these small mowings were left for the boy to bring in on his wheelbarrow. Another source of fodder supply was the field of Indian corn. Around the bases of the hills there sprouted up many surplus shoots of a foot or two in length known as suckers. These were of no earthly use where they were, and the boy on a small farm had often the privilege of an afternoon of cutting a load of these suckers for the cows. Among them he gathered a good many full-grown stalks that had no ears on them. Later there was a whole patch of fodder corn sown in furrows on some piece of late ploughed ground to gather from. He had to bring in as heavy a load as he could wheel every night, and on Saturday an extra one to last over Sunday. The cows had to have attention one way or another the year through. They were most aggravating, perhaps when in September the shortness of feed in the pasture made them covetous of the contents of the neighboring fields. Sometimes the boy would sight them in the corn. His first great anxiety was not about the corn, but as to whether they were his folks' cows or some of the neighbors. He would much rather warn someone else than undertake the cow-chasing himself. If his study of the color and spotting of the cows proved they were his, he went in and told his mother, then got his stick and took a beeline across the fields. He was wrathfully inclined when he started, and he became much more so when he found out how much disposed the cows were to keep tearing around in the corn or to racing about the fields in as many different directions as there were animals. He and the rest of the school had lately become members of the Band of Mercy, and on ordinary occasions he had a kindly feeling for his cows, but now he was ready to throw all sentiment overboard, and he would break his stick over the back of any one of these cows if she would give him the chance, which she very unkindly would not. He had lost his temper, and now he lost his breath, and he just dripped with perspiration. He dragged himself along at a panting walk, and he found, after all, that this did fully as well as all the racing and shouting he had been indulging in. Indeed, he was not sure, but that the cows had got the notion that he had come out to have a little caper over the farm with them for his personal enjoyment. All things have an end, and in time the boy made the last cow leap the gap in the broken fence back into the pasture. They, every one, went to browsing, as if nothing had happened, or looked at him mildly with an inquiring forward tilt of the ears, as if they wanted to know what all this row was about anyway. The boy put back the knocked-down rails, staked things up as well as he knew how, picked some peppermint by the brook to munch on, and trudged off home. When he had drunk a quart or so of water and eaten three cookies, he began to feel himself again. Besides all the extra foddering mentioned, it is customary on the small farms to give the cows, late in the year, an hour or two's baiting each day. The cows are baited along the roadside at first, but after the rowan is cut, they are allowed to roam about the grass fields. Of course, it is the boy who has to watch them. There are unfenced crops and the apples that lie thick under the trees to be guarded, not to mention the turnips in the newly seeded lot and the cabbages on the hill that will spoil the milk if the cows get them. The boundary line fences, too, are out of repair, and the cows seem to have a great anxiety to get over on the neighbor's premises, even if the feed is much scantier than in the field where they are feeding. The boy brings out a book, and he settles himself with his back against a fence post and plans for an easy time. The cows seem to understand the situation, and they go exploring round, as the boy says, in the most sensible fashion he ever saw, wouldn't keep nowhere nor anywhere else. He tries to make them stay within bounds by yelling at them while sitting where he is, but they do not seem to care the least bit about his remarks unless he is right behind them with a stick in his hand. The cows do not allow the boy to suffer for lack of exercise, and the hero in the book he is reading has continually to be deserted in the most desperate situations while he runs off to give those cows a training. There is one of the cow's relations that the boy has a particular fondness for. I mean the calf. On small farms, the lone summer calf is tethered handily about the premises somewhere out of doors. Every day or two, when it has nibbed and trodden the circuit of grass in its tether pretty thoroughly, it is moved to a fresh spot. The boy does this, and he feeds the calf its milk each night and morning. If the calf is very young, it does not know enough to drink, and the boy has to dip its fingers in the milk and let the calf suck them while he entices it by gradually lowering his hand to put its nose in the pail. When he gets his hand into the milk and the calf imagines it is getting lots of milk out of the boy's fingers, he will gently withdraw them. The calf is inclined to resent this by giving a vigorous buck with his head. Very likely the boy gets slopped, but he knows well enough what to expect, not to allow himself to be sent sprawling. He repeats the finger process until in time the calf will drink alone, but he never can get it to stop bucking. Indeed, he does not try very hard, except occasionally, for he finds this butting rather entertaining, and sometimes he does not object to butting his own head against the calf's. He and the calf cut many a caper together before the summer is through. Things become most exciting when the calf gets loose. It will go galloping all about the premises. It has no regard for the garden or the flower plants or the linen laid out on the grass to dry. It makes the chickens squawk and scamper, and the turkeys gobble and the geese gabble. Its heels go kicking through the air in all sorts of positions, its tail is elevated like a flagpole, and there is a rattling chain hitched to its neck that is jerking along in its company. The calf is liable to step on this chain, and then it stands on its head with a marvelous suddenness. The women and girls all come out to save their linen and shoo the calf off when it approaches the flowers, but it is the boy that takes on himself the task of capturing the crazy animal. The women folks seem much distressed by the calf's performance, while the boy is so overcome with the funniness of his calf that he is only halfway effective in his chasing. At last the calf apparently sees something it never noted before, for it comes down on its four legs, stock still, and stretches its ears forward as if in great amazement. Now is the boy's chance. He steals up and grabs the end of the chain, but at that moment the calf concludes that it sees nothing worthy of astonishment, and starts off again full tilt, trailing a small boy behind, whose twinkling legs never went so fast before, and it is a question if things are not in a more desperate state than they were previously. By this time the boy's father and a few of the neighbor's boys appear on the scene, and between them all the calf gets confused, and allows himself to be tethered once more in the most docile subjection. You would not think the gentle little creature, who is so mildly nibbling off the clover leaves, was capable of such vile doings. On farms where oxen are, the boy is allowed to bring up and train a pair of steers. While the training is going on, you can hear the boy shouting out his threats and commands from one end of the town to the other. Even old Grandpa Smith, who has been deaf as a stone these 10 years, asked what the noise was about when our boy began training steers. By dint of his shoutings and whackings, it was no great time before the boy had the steers, so that they were quite respectable. He got them so they would turn and twist according to his directions almost any way, and he could make them snake the clumsy old cart he hitched them into over any sort of country he pleased. He trained them so they would trot quite well too. Altogether, he was proud of them, and believed they would beat any steers in the county clean out of sight. He was going to take them to the cattle show some time, and see if they would not. Cattle show comes in the autumn, usually about the time of the first frost. There is some very early rising among the farmers on the morning of the great day, for they must get their flocks under way promptly, or they will be late. Every kind of farm creature has its place on the grounds, and in the big hall are displayed quantities of fruits and vegetables that are the biggest and best ever seen, and samples of cooking and samples of sewing, and a bed quilt that an old lady made after she was 90 years old that has about 1,000,000 pieces in it, and another one that Anne Maria Totkins made, who is only 10 years old, that has about 900,000 pieces in it, and a picture in oils that this same Anne Maria Totkins painted, and some other paintings, and lots of fancy things, and all sorts of remarkable work that women and girls can do, and a boy isn't good for anything at. However, the boy admires all this handiwork, and is astonished at the big squash that grew in one summer, and weighs twice as much as he does, and surveys the fruits with watery mouth, and exclaims when he gets to the potatoes, any one of which would almost fill a quart measure, "Jiminy, wouldn't those be the fellers to pick up, though?" "I don't think you use very nice language," says Eddie's older sister, who is nearly through the high school. "Well, you don't know much about picking up potatoes," is Eddie's retort. There are more chances to spend money than you can shake a stick at on the cattle show grounds. All sorts of men are walking around through the crowd with popcorn and candies and gay little balloons and whistles and such things to sell, and there are booths where you can see how much you can pound and how much you can lift and how straight you can throw an egg at a nigger's head stuck through a canvas 2 rods away. There are shooting galleries, and there is a phonograph where you tuck some little tubes into your ears and hear the famous baritone, August William de Monk, sing the latest songs, and it is so funny you cannot help laughing. Of course, the boy cannot invest in all the things he sees at the fair. He has to stop when his pocket money runs out. But there is lots of free fun, such as a chance to roam around and look on at everything, and he has quantities of handbills and brightly colored cards and pamphlets thrust upon him, all of which he faithfully stores away in his gradually bulging pockets and takes home to consider at leisure. For a number of days afterward he squeaks about in his journeyings with his whistles and jew harps and other noisemakers purchased at the fair with great persistency, but these things soon get broken, and the pamphlets and circulars he gathered get scattered, and the occasion may be said to have been brought to an end by his finding, 2 Sundays later, a lone peanut in his jacket pocket. It was in church time, and he was at great pains to crack it quietly, so that he could eat it at once. He succeeded, though he had to assume great innocence and a remarkably steadfast interest in the preacher, when his mother glanced his way suspiciously as she heard the shucks crush. Autumn is a time of harvest. The potato field has first attention. When the boy's father is otherwise busied, he has to go out alone and do digging and all, unless he can persuade his smaller brothers and sisters to bring along their little express wagon and assist. In such a case he spends about half his time showing them how, and offering inducements to keep them at work. Usually it is the men folks who dig, and the boy who has to do most of the picking up. After he has handled about 5 bushels of the dirty things, he has had enough of it, but he cannot desert. It is one of the great virtues of farm life that the boy must learn to do disagreeable tasks, and to stick to them in the finish, however irksome they are. It gives the right kind of boy a decided advantage in the battles of life that come later, whatever his field of industry. He has the courage to undertake and persistence to carry out plans that boys of milder experience will never dare to cope with. Potato fields that have been neglected in the drive of other work in their ripening weeks flourish often at digging time with many weedy jungle. This made digging slow, but the economical small farmer saw some gain in the fact, for he could feed the weeds to the pigs. After the midday digging, while the boy's father was carrying the bags of potatoes down cellar, the boy wheeled in a few loads of the weeds. The pigs were very glad to come wallowing up from the barnyard mire to the bars where the boy threw the weeds over. They grunted and crunched with great satisfaction. When the boy brought in the last load, he had a little conversation with the pigs, and he scratched the fattest one's back with a piece of board, until the stout porker lay down on its side and curled up the corner of its mouth and grunted as if in the seventh heaven of bliss. A little later in the fall, the onions have to be topped, the beets pulled, the carrots spaded out, and the corn cut. Work at the corn in one shape or another hangs on until snow flies. The men do most of the cutting and binding, though the boy often assists, but what he is sure to do is to drop the straw and to hand up the bundles when they are ready for stacking, and gather the scattered pumpkins and put them under the stacks to protect them from the frost. He likes to play that these stacks are Indian tents, and he will crowd himself in among their slanting stalks till he is out of sight. He picks out one or two good-sized green pumpkins that night from among those that they have brought home to feed to the cows, and hollows them out and cuts awful faces on them for jack-o'-lanterns. He fixes with considerable trouble a place in the bottom for a candle, and gets the younger children to come out on the steps while he lights up. They are filled with delight and fright by the ghostly heads with their strangely glowing features and their grinning saw-toothed mouths. The boy goes sailing around the yard with them, and puts them on fence posts, and carries them up a ladder, and cuts up all sorts of antics with them. Finally, the younger children are called in, and the boy gets lonesome and blows out his candle, and puts the jack-o'-lanterns away for another occasion. On days following, there is much corn-husking in the fields, which the boy assists at, though the breaking off of the tough cobs is often no easy matter, and it makes his wrists and fingers ache. Towards sundown, the farmer frequently brings home a load to husk in the evening, and for the morrow's work should the day chance to be rainy. In the autumn, it is quite common to do an hour or two's work in the barn of an evening, though the boy does not fancy the arrangement much, and begs off when he can think of a good excuse. In October, the apples have to be picked. The pickers go to the orchard armed with baskets, ropes, and ladders, and the wagon brings out a load of barrels and scatters them about among the trees. It looks dangerous the way the boy will worm about among the branches and pursue the apples out to the tips of the smallest limbs. He never falls, though he many times comes near it. The way he hangs on seems to confirm the truth of the theory that he was descended from monkey ancestors. But the boy is on the ground much of the time, emptying the baskets the men let down into barrels, and picking up the best of the windfalls, and gathering the rest of the apples on the ground into heaps for cider. It is a treat to take the cider apples to mill. There is always something going on there, always other teams and other boys, and great bins of waiting apples and creaking machinery, and an atmosphere full of cidery odors. The boy loses no time in hunting up a good straw, and finding a newly filled barrel with the bung out, he establishes prompt connections with the cider by means of the straw, and fills himself up with sweetness. When he has enough and has wiped his mouth with the sleeve, he remarks that he guesses he has lowered the cider some. When they brought their own cider home and propped up the barrels in the yard next the shop, the boy kept a bunch of straws conveniently stored, and as long as he called the cider sweet, he frequently drew on the barrel's contents. When the cider grew hard, he took to visiting the apple bins more frequently, and if you noticed him closely, you would almost always see that he has bunches in his pockets that showed that he was well provided with these food stores. The great day of the fall for the boy was that on which he and a lot of other fellows went chestnutting. They had been planning it and talking it over for a week beforehand. The sun had not been long up when they started off across the frosty quiet of the pastures. Some had tin pails, some had bags, some had both. One boy had hopes so high that he carried three bags that would hold half a bushel each. Most of them had salt bags that would contain two or three quarts. Several carried clubs to knock off the chestnuts that still clung in the burrs. They were all in eager chatter as they tramped and skipped and climbed the fences and rolled stones down the hillside and whirled their pails about their heads and waited for the smallest boy, who was getting left behind, to catch up, and did all those other things that boys do when they are off that way. How they raced to be first when they neared the chestnut trees. There was a scattering and a shouting over vines and a rustling among the fallen leaves. The nuts were not so numerous that it took them long to clear the ground. Then they threw their clubs, but the limbs were too high for their strength to be effective, and they soon gave up and went on to find more trees. The chestnuts rattled on the bottoms of their tin pails, and the boys with bags twisted them up and exhibited to each other the knobs of nuts within. As the sun rose higher, the grass became wet with melted frost, and the wind began to blow in dashing little breezes that kept increasing in force till the whole wood was set to singing and fluttering. The boys enjoyed the briskness of the gale, and agreed, besides, that it would bring down the chestnuts. They wandered on over knolls and through hollows, sometimes in the brown pastures, sometimes in the ragged autumn forest patches. They clubbed and climbed and picked, and bruised their shins and got chestnut burr prickles into their fingers, and they had some squabbles among themselves, and the smallest boy tumbled and got the nosebleed and shed tears, and it took the whole company to comfort him. On the whole, though, they got on very well. At noon, the biggest boy, who had a watch, told them it was 12 o'clock, and they stopped on the sunny side of a pine grove, where there was a brook that slipped down over some rocks nearby, and ate their dinner. The wind was whistling and swaying high up among the pine tops, and now and then a tiny whirlwind caught up the leaves beyond the brook and dashed them into a white birch thicket. In the sheltered nook where the boys sat, the wind barely touched them, and they ate and drank from the brook and lounged about afterward in great comfort. They followed the little stream down a rough ravine, where they again started and went through the same experiences as those of the morning. They saw two grey squirrels, they heard a hound baying on the mountain, and there was a gun fired off somewhere in the woods. They found a crow's nest, only it was so high in a tree they could not get it, and they picked up many pretty stones by the side of the brook that they put in with their chestnuts. They got under one tree that was in sight of an orchard where a man was picking apples. The man halloed to them to get out of there, and after a little hesitation, for the spot was a promising one, they straggled off into the woods again. While they travelled, they did a good deal of odd eating. They made way with an occasional chestnut, and they found birch and mountain mint, and dug some sassafras root, which they ate after getting most of the dirt off. The biggest boy's name was Tom Cook, and he would eat almost anything. He would eat acorns, with the rest found too bitter, and he would chew pine and hemlock needles, and sweet fern leaves, and all such things. He got out his knife while they were crossing a pasture, and cut out a plug of bark from a pine tree, and scraped out the pitch and juice next the wood, and said it was sweet. The others tried it, and it was sweet, though they did not care much for it. In the late afternoon, the squad of boys came out on a precipice of rocks that overhung a pond. The wind had gone down, and the sun was getting low, and it seemed best that they should start homeward. They were back among the scattered houses of the village just as the evening had begun to get dusky and frosty. The smallest boy had more than a pint of chestnuts, and the biggest boy had as many as 3 quarts, not counting stones and other rubbish. The day had been a great success, but they felt as if they had trudged 1,000 miles, and were almost too tired to eat supper. However, when the boy began to tell his adventure, and set forth in glowing terms his triumphs and trials, and listed the wonderful things he had seen, his spirits revived, and in the evening he was able to superintend the boiling of a cup of the chestnuts he had gathered, and to do his share of the eating. When the chestnut burrs opened, autumn was at its height. Now it began to decline. Every breeze set loose relays of the gaudy leaves, and sent them fluttering to the earth in a many-tinted shower, and the bare twigs and the increasing sharpness of the morning frost warned the farm dwellers that winter was fast approaching. End of Part 4, Autumn. Read for you by Chiquito Crasto, Birmingham, Alabama. Part 5 of The Farmer's Boy by Clifton Johnson. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Read for you by Chiquito Crasto. Part 5, Country Children in General. In this final chapter, I propose to gather up some of the loose threads of my narrative that for one reason or another missed attention in the earlier chapters, and to study the effect on his character of the life the farmer's boy leads. Besides, I wish to tell you something of the farmer's girls. They are an important part of the family life which this book attempts to portray, and I have given them too scant attention. They are not so important as the boys, to be sure, if we accept the latter's opinion, though you might think, after he gets to be 16 or 17, he thought them more so, from the amount of attention he gives them. The small girl's likes and dislikes, her enthusiasms and pleasures, are to a large degree identical with the boy's. She will beat him half the time in the races that they run. If she has rubber boots, she is just as good a wader. She can play ball, climb fences, slide downhill, skate, indeed, do almost anything the boy can, with just the same interest and enjoyment. The girl is often a leader in roaming and adventure, and some girls make excellent outdoor workers too. A lively and capable girl often wishes, I fancy, that she was a boy and might have the boy's outdoor freedom, and sometimes, too, she envies his opportunity to cope with vigorous work and win a name and place in the world. At any rate, she wishes she could slip away from the confining housework and more sober demeanor which she is expected to have. On farms where boys are lacking, the girls sometimes, of necessity, do the boys' work. They drive the cows to pasture, help in hoeing and weeding, load the hay, and pick up potatoes. But usually, they only hover around the edges of the outdoor work. They take care of a corner in the garden and a strip of flower bed, feed the chickens, run on errands, and help pick apples. The smallest girls, unless their folks are uncommonly particular, run around about as they please, and dip into as many different kinds of work as they choose, and they get just as smutty and dirty as any of the boys. When the girls get into long dresses, they become more and more particular as to what they are seen doing about the fields, and they avoid anything but the lightest muscular exertion, and not all of them even dare to make a spectacle of themselves by riding around on the horse rake and tedder. The girl is early taught to wash and wipe the dishes, to sweep, to mend rents, and sew on buttons. The boy has to acknowledge that in these things his sister beats him. She can do every one quicker and better than he can, though he claims that the buttons she sews on will come off, and that, give him time enough, he can sew a button on so that he can depend on that button's staying where it was put to his last days. It is certain, too, that the girl is apt to be quicker with her mind than the boy. She has her lessons better in school, and she is more docile in her behavior. Often she is the boy's helper and adviser in all sorts of difficulties and troubles, and is a companion who is safer and better for him in almost every way than any of his mates. We all crave a sympathetic understanding and interest in our doings. It is the mothers and sisters who are more apt to have these qualities, and it is to them that the boys go more freely with their woes and pleasures. They are far safe confidants than the rest of the world, and the boy is likely to have reason for sorrow in later life because he did not follow their wishes and advice more closely. All kinds of boys are to be found on our New England farms, good and bad, handsome and homely, bright and dull, strong and weak, courageous and timid, generous and mean. I think the better qualities predominate. The typical boy is a sturdy, wholesome-looking little fellow, with chubby cheeks that are well tanned and freckled in summer, and that in the winter takes a rosy glow from the keenness of the air. The same is more mildly true of the appearance of the little girls, and with some advantages in their favor. You take a group of country girls some June morning on their way to school, with their fresh faces and clean, starched aprons. They look, as Artemus Ward says, nice enough to eat without sass or seasoning. As the children grow up, they are apt to lose much of their simplicity and attraction. They become self-conscious, and in many ways artificial, particularly in their manner and in their pleasures. This is not especially apparent in their work, and there are those who continue to a large degree refreshingly earnest and natural in whatever they do, and country life all through, with its general habits of labor and economy and its comparative seclusion, is less artificial than that of the cities. Yet there are the same tendencies in both places. The girl becomes increasingly anxious about the mode of her dress. She wants to have all the latest puckers of the world of fashion. She twists and cuts off and curls and frizzes her hair, and she braids it and rolls it and makes it stand on end in her effort to find the adjustment most becoming to her style of beauty. The result sometimes is that she has the appearance of having gone crazy. She wears toothpick-toed, high-heeled shoes and declares publicly that they couldn't be more comfortable, while privately she complains of corns. For society use, she cultivates a cultured tone of voice, and some tosses of the head, rolling up of the eyeballs, shrugging of the shoulders, etc., calculated to be killing. She has an idea that it is becoming in her to appear to take fright easily, and she screeches at sudden noises, and is in a panic at the appearance of the most scared and tiny of mice. A good deal of this is done for its effect on the boys. It seems to interest and entertain them, and keep them hanging around. The girls sentimentalize a good deal about the boys when they get into their teens. They keep track of who is going with who, and pick his looks and characteristics, in their shallow way, all to ravelings. What a fellow says, how he curls his mustache, how he parts his hair, how horridly or how well he dances, how late it was when he got home from the last party, etc., are discussed at all kinds of times and places. Two girls who have come home from meeting together some cold autumn night will loiter and freeze to death at the gate where they are to part, talking for an hour or more over the fellows after this manner. The result is that their minds come into a state where subjects without a gossipy or sentimental turn have no interest. As a rule, the boys fall into the girls' ways and, noting how the current runs, encourage them. There is among the young people a good deal of flirtation, which I take to be a kind of aimless play, both of talk and manner, that hangs around the borders of the sentimental and often gets a good way beyond it. The boy who avoids this sort of thing is said to be bashful. He is afraid of the girls, has no sentiment, and all that. This may be a sufficient explanation in some cases, but in others the trouble is not in the girls, but in this kind of girls. It may be because the boy has more sentiment than the average that this sort of society is distasteful to him. Most boys are not as sentimental as are most girls. They are more workaday and practical. Their life, in the matter of getting a living, has more responsibility than the girls. At the same time, the boy gains a coarseness of thought and feeling, often in his companionship with the men and boys he is thrown in with that the girl is almost altogether free from. It is a curious idea of manliness a boy sometimes has. He tries to express a grown-up competence to take care of himself by a rough manner and rude speech, an ability to enter into the spirit of the worst kind of conversation and stories, not only without a blush, but with sympathetic guffaws of laughter. He resents his parents' authority. He likes to resort to the loafing places where he has leisure. He aspires to smoke and chew and spit, like the rest of the loafers there. This may be an extreme picture, but there are a vast number of boys it will fit to a degree. Most country boys admire the gentility of smoking, and will be at great pains to acquire the habit after they get to be 15 or 16 years old. Perhaps the average boy never becomes a frequent smoker, but he likes the pleasurable feeling of independence it gives him when he starts off for a ride to have a cigar tilted neatly upwards from the corner of his mouth. It stamps him a gentleman to all beholders, and the lookers-on know from his manner and cigar that he is a person of vigorous and stoutly held opinions that it would be best not to attempt any fooling with. When you see a young man gaily riding by, sitting up very straight with his best clothes on and his 5-cent cigar scenting the air with its gentle aroma, you may know he is going to take his girl to ride. If he can by any manner of means find the money at this time of his career, the young man buys a fast horse and a shiny buggy carriage. He fairly dazzles your eyes as he flits swiftly past. Sometimes it takes more than one horse to finish his coating, for the first one may die of old age before he gets through. But whatever disappointment the young man suffers in his love affairs, and however his fancy or what not makes him change one girl for another, you cannot see, when he starts on his journeys, that he has ever lost aught of that first freshness of demeanour that characterised him, and the perfume of his cigar has the same old 5-cent fragrance. After all, these young fellows who go skirmishing around in this fashion are mostly hearty and good-natured. When such a one marries, his horse goes slower, the polish wears off from his carriage, he neglects his cigar, and the two settle down, as a rule, into a very staid and comfortable sort of folks. They might have been wiser, they might have got more from life. So could we, all of us. Shakespeare said that all the world loves a lover, and people are fond of repeating this saying, but that was 300 years ago. I don't know how it was then, nor how it is in other parts of the world now. I am very sure, however, that New England people do not love a lover. He is a butt for more poor jokes than any other character. We think he's ridiculous. We call him off and set him on and scare him and encourage him. We at least make that other saying come true, that faint heart ne'er won fair lady. As for the girl, I imagine that among her friends, she gets a gentler and more cuddling treatment. Even the smallest children in some families have to endure a lot of talk from their elders about their girls and fellows. That is the most sickly sort of sentimentality. If let alone, the children's minds do not run much on these lines, though they occasionally, in their innocent way, build some very pretty castles in the air that soon melt away harmlessly into nothing in the warmth of their other interests. Boys, when they begin to go to the larger schools of a town, are apt to learn a variety of rough tricks, exclamations, and slang that shock the folks at home when the boys get to showing off within their sight and hearing. With the best of them, the largest part of this presently wears off. Others cultivate their accomplishments, and even make their conversation emphatic with certain of the swear words. Such boys the righteous of the community condemn as altogether bad, though it sometimes happens that even they have redeeming traits. I do not think that lying is a common fault of country boys, though most of them find themselves at times in circumstances that make it difficult to abstain from giving the truth a pretty severe straining, and perhaps most have two or three lies on their consciences that are undoubtedly black. But the boy has probably repented these in shame and sorrow, and hopes he never will be tempted again to tell one of the untruths he so despises. Really bad and unblushing lying a boy is apt to learn, if ever, after he gets among the older and rougher boys who hang around the post offices every evening at mail time, or who attend the center schools of the town. The farm, more than most places, tends to give children habits of thrift and singleness of purpose in the pursuit of education. There is seclusion enough on the majority of farms, so that the children are not confused by a multiplicity of amusements and too much going on. This seclusion may make some dull, but to others it gives a concentrated energy that makes them all through life untiring workers and stout thinkers. Often from such a start, they become the world's leaders in many widely scattered fields of usefulness. Because you are a farm boy, it is not, however, certain that you have only to seek the city to win fame and fortune. The city is already crowded with workers and with ability. It is a lonely, homesick place, and many years must pass before a person can win even a position of safety and comfort. The boys with good habits and health and a strong will have the best chance. The boy with loose habits and a lack of energy will find more temptations to a weak and purposeless career than in the country. Some boys and girls can live lives of wider usefulness in the large towns than in the country, and it is best for them to go there. But it is a serious question for most whether they will gain anything by the change. It was my plan in this book to take the farmer's boy straight through the year. There still remains a final month that has not been treated. With Thanksgiving, autumn ends and winter begins. The trees have been bare for some time, the grasses withered brown, and the landscape white with frost every morning. There have been high winds whistling about the farm buildings and scurrying through the leaf litter of the fields. Snow squalls have whitened the air, and the roadway pools have frequently been glazed with ice. But the solid freezing and snows of winter are not looked for until after Thanksgiving. The boy gets out his old mittens and his cloth cap that he can pull down over his ears, and he keeps his coat collar turned up, and hugs himself, and draws himself into a narrower compass as he does his outdoor work. On some cold morning, he gets out his sled, and if he finds a bank steep enough, he slides down on the frost very well. He tries such ice as comes in his way, and of course breaks through and gets his feet muddy. Then real winter comes. The world is all white, and the sleigh bells jingle along the road, and the ponds and rivers are bridged with solid ice. The boy, with some other boys, and perhaps some of the girls too, is often out with his sled. They do a good deal of sliding down the steepest kind of hills, indeed, that is the sort that they search out. And if it has a few lively bumps in it, so much the better. They dash down the decline in the most reckless fashion, and then keep going up a little higher to make the descent still faster and more exciting. One little fellow who lies flat on his sled and steers with his toes gets slewed out of the track and goes rolling over and over with his sled in a cloud of flying snow. You would think it would be the end of him, but he gets tipped, dazed, and powdered white from head to foot, and his lip quivers, and some tears trickle from his eyes. He says in his shaky voice that he's going home. The other boys gather round and brush him off, and Willie Hooper lends him his handkerchief, when the boy can't find his own. And they tell him how he looked going over and over, and what he ought to have done, and that he is all right, and to come on now. There ain't no use of going in just for that. We'll have a lot of fun yet. The boy finds himself comforted, and in a few minutes he's as lively, careering down the hill with the others, as ever. By the time a boy gets to be 6 or 7 years old, he expects to find a pair of skates in his Christmas stocking. For some time after that, his head accumulates bumps of a kind that would be apt to puzzle a phrenologist. It is astonishing in what a sudden and unexpected manner the skates will slip from under you. There's not even a chance to throw out your hands to save yourself. You are in luck if you can manage to sit down instead of going full length. Your ankles wobble unaccountably, and the moment you leave off mincing along in a sort of awkward short-step walk and try to strike out, down you go on your head. Then your skate straps are always loosening or getting under your skates and tripping you up, and your feet become cold and your mittens get wet. But the boy keeps at it with a perseverance under difficulty and disaster that would accomplish wonders if applied to work. In time, he can skim around with any of them and play shinny and skate backward and in a circle and cut a figure eight in the ice and almost do a number of other remarkable things. The boy who skates much has to experience a few breakings through the ice. On the little ponds and near the shore, this is often fun, and the boy who dares go nearest to the weak places and slides longest on a bender is a hero in his mate's estimation, and I might add, in his own. When he does break in, he very likely only gets his feet wet, and he does not mind that very much. But when he breaks through in some deep place, and does not grip the ice until he is in up to his arms, it is no smiling matter. He usually scrambles out quickly enough, but the worst of it comes in getting home in his freezing clothing, that conducts the chill of the frosty air clear to his bones. Yet it rarely happens that anything serious comes of these accidents. The year goes out with Christmas, the holiday that perhaps shines brightest of all the list in the boy's mind. A few days before its advent, he and his folks visit the town where all the stores are to make the necessary purchases. They do much mysterious advising together, but never as a family group. There always is at least one shut out. It takes a great deal of consideration and calculation to make 49 cents go around among all your friends. But the members of the family are usually considerate, and when the boy fishes for hints of their likes, they make it clear in suggesting the thing they most want, that he will not have to spend such a great deal. Then, while he is buying in the store, the others that happen to be with him are always good enough to stand by the door and look the other way, so that, of course, when they get their presents, they are a great surprise to them. Each of the children brings home various little packages, which they are at great pains to hide away from the others, though they cannot forbear to talk about them darkly, and make the others guess, until they are almost telling themselves. Some of them, particularly the girls, are apt to be making things about this time, and you have to be careful how you notice what is left lying around, or you discover secrets. And there is likely to be a sudden hustling of things out of sight when you come into the room, and looks of such exaggerated innocence, that you know something is going on. If you show an inclination to stop, your sister says, "Come now, Tommy, do go along." "What for?" says Tommy. "Oh, you've been in the house long enough," is a reply. "Well, I guess I want to get warm," Tommy continues. "It's pretty cold outdoors. Say, what is it you're sitting on, Nell, anyway?" "I didn't say I was sitting on anything," says Nellie. "You just go along out or you shan't have it." Tom blows his nose and laughs and pulls on his mittens and shuffles off. On Christmas Eve, the children hang up their stockings back of the stove and are hopeful of presents in spite of the disbelief they express in the possibility of Santa Claus coming down the stovepipe. Sure enough, in the morning the stockings are all bunchy with the things in them, and the children have a great celebration, pulling them out and getting the wraps off the packages. They do all this without stopping to get more than half dressed, and breakfast has to wait for them. They are in no haste, for they have popcorn and candy to munch on that they found in their stockings, and everyone has to show all his things to each of the rest, and see all the others have, and spring the baby's jack-in-the-box about half a dozen times till they get used to the fright of it. They have better things to eat that day than usual, and more of them, and with that, and the sweetmeats and extras, some of the children are likely to get sick and quarrelsome before the day is out. In the evening there is perhaps a Christmas tree at the schoolhouse. There has been a turmoil of preparation in the neighborhood for several days previous, for the children have to be set learning pieces, and practicing, and fixing up costumes, and cakes and cookies, and all the good things to eat have to be made ready, and someone has to collect the dimes and nickels and quarters to get candy and oranges and Christmas tree trimmings with. Then some two or three have to make a journey to the woods and chop a good branchy hemlock or spruce of the right size and get it set up in the corner of the schoolhouse. Finally, the green curtains have to be hung that will separate the audience from the stage, where the small people do their acting and speak their pieces. The whole village turned out in the evening. They came on foot and they came in teams. Usually, each group carried a lantern to light its way, and these were set in the entry when their bearers went in. The schoolhouse windows were aglow with light, and within things fairly glittered to the children's eyes. There were six lamps along the walls, besides those back of the curtains, and every one was lighted and turned up almost to the smoking point. Everybody was there, besides four boys from the next village who sat on a front seat, and James Peterson's dog. Some of the big people got into some of the small seats, and certain of the neighbors who didn't get along very well with certain others had to manage carefully not to run across each other's courses. The air was full of the hum of talk, and the young people were running all about the open spaces and in and out the door, and there were consultations and gigglings and flurries over things forgotten or lost or something else, without number. The curtain was drawn, but you could see the top of the gaily loaded tree over it, and the movement of feet under it, and you could see queer shadows of figures within, doing mysterious things on it. Sometimes a figure brushed against the curtain, and it came bulging way out into the room, and the four boys from the next town had the greatest work to keep from exploding over the funniness of this, and, as it was, one of them tumbled off from the narrow seat he occupied. By and by there was a quieting in the flurry up in front, and someone stood before the curtain with a paper in his hand, and announced that the first exercise of the evening would be so and so. There was no astonishing genius shown in what followed, but a person would have to be very dyspeptic not to enjoy the simplicity and earnestness of it all. Each child had his or her individual way, and some were so small they could only pipe and lisp the words, and you didn't know what they said, but when they made their little bows and hurried off to find their mothers, you and the rest of the audience were delighted and applauded just the same. There was a melodeon at one side of the room, and the school sang some songs, and one of the young ladies sang a solo all alone, and they had a dialogue with Santa Claus in it, who was so dressed up in a long beard and a fur coat and a deep voice that you wouldn't have any idea it was only Hiram Taylor. At length came the Christmas tree. How handsome it looked, with all the packages and bright things hung among its green twigs, and the strings of popcorn looped all about, and the oranges and candy bags dangling everywhere. Three or four of the young people took off the presents and called out names, and kept everybody growing happier and happier. When the tree was bare, and even the popcorn and candy bags and oranges had been distributed, some of the women folk got lively in a corner, where there was a table piled all over with baskets and boxes. Then plates began to circulate around, and it was found that there was a pot boiling on the stove, and a smell of coffee and chocolate in the air. About 19 different kinds of cakes started on their wanderings, and there were biscuit and something to drink, and nuts that were partly walnuts and partly stone nuts, and you had a chance to talk with everybody and show your presence, and altogether had so good a time that you felt as if it would last the whole year through. It would take many books to tell all there is to tell about the farmer's boy, and what better place is there to leave him than this Christmas night, with the rest of the family snugged up among the robes of the sleigh on the way home. The lantern on the dashboard flashes its light along the road ahead, the horse's hoofs strike crisply on the frozen snow, the bells jingle, and the sky overhears glitters full of radiant stars. In the gliding sleigh are the children, holding their precious presents in their laps, and still in animated conversation they review the events of the evening. The sleigh moves on. They are lost to sight. The book is ended. End of Part 5. Country Children in General. End of The Farmer's Boy by Clifton Johnson. Read for you by Chiquito Crasto, Birmingham, Alabama.